Uhu. Uhu. Oke, sekali good morning students. Setelah beberapa waktu, kali ini Sensei bakal membahas soal IBO atau International Biology Olympiad. Tepatnya IBO tahun 2017 nomor 1 sampai nomor 12. Karena ini masih part satunya. So, today we will try to answer some question from 2017 IBO or International Biology Olympiad. Specifically, in this first part, we will answer question 1 until 12.
Hey, that's pretty good.
Jadi, khusus video IBO, Sensei bakal bicara dalam dua bahasa, Indonesia dan Inggris. Jadi, tiap satu kalimat itu Sensei bakal pindah-pindah bahasa gitu. So, you can call me Sensei. I'm a biology instructor from Indonesia, and I'll be speaking in two languages in this video. Mostly in Bahasa Indonesia, cause I'm an Indonesian. But I'll try my best to translate every single sentence from Indonesia into English. I'm sorry that I cannot speak English fluently. And maybe I'll need to use translator or something like that during this video. Oh iya, link sumber soal dan kunci jawabannya ada di deskripsi ya. Jadi, di sini Sensei lebih ke sharing video-video lain atau jurnal gitu mungkin yang menyangkut soal nomor 1 sampai 12. Biar kalian tahu dasar ilmunya dan lebih mendalam pemahamannya daripada sekedar kunci jawaban. So, I already put the link to access IBO site that contain the question and answer sheet below. And in this video, I'll give you a link to other web videos from various sources, or maybe a research paper, so that you can understand the scientific basis of the question we are discussing about. Not only know the answer key. Disclaimer: I make this purely for educational purpose and not commercial. I already turn off my ads for this video, so if there is an ad, that's only comes from YouTube policy, not from me personally. So I earn nothing. All of the questions come from International Biology Olympiad Committee or website. So all of the copyrights belong to them. Okay, kembali lagi ke bahasa Indonesia. Jadi, walaupun ini soal IBO, soal ini masih sangat bagus untuk dipelajari walaupun kalian baru mau ikut KSNK atau KSNP gitu. Kalian juga bisa cek video pembahasan KSN di channel Sensei. Ada banyak tuh, dari nomor 1 sampai nomor 50. Atau kalian bisa klik card di pojok kanan atas untuk langsung cus ke playlistnya. Jangan lupa share video ini ke antek-antek KSN lainnya agar pendidikan gratis seperti ini bisa semakin menyebar. Don't forget to share this video to your Olympiad friends. So, without further ado, let's start the learning session. Boom. Okay. Now, in this question sheet, they didn't add the number here. So we have no number. We have to add this number. Like this is the first question, okay? Jadi sebenarnya di pertanyaan ini ya, lembar pertanyaan itu dia nggak nyantumin nomor. Jadi cuma pertanyaan, pertanyaan, pertanyaan gitu. Jadi kita nambahin nomornya manual aja ya. Dan ini adalah pertanyaan nomor 1. So, first, you can read the opening here. Okay, you can read this. And I'll read this with you. Okay, so, here we have some DNA sequencing techniques, okay? Actually, we have three techniques below. And we have to sequence 100,000 genomes, okay, from a rare disease patient. But different sequencing technologies have different merits for this purpose, as described below. Okay, so we have three techniques and we don't really know which one we have to use. Okay, so we have to find it. Jadi di sini ya, kalian bisa baca dulu soalnya atau soal pembukanya ya ini. Nah, kalian bisa baca ini. Jadi di sini kita punya beberapa teknik DNA sequencing. Kita punya tiga ya, di bawah ini kita punya tiga DNA sequencing teknik. Dan kita harus mensequence 100.000 genom dari penyakit langka, gitu ya. Tapi setiap teknologi itu punya tujuan yang berbeda. Nah, jadi tiga teknologi ini kita nggak bisa pakai semua. Jadi satu tujuan ya satu teknologi, gitu ya. Jadi kita perlu menyocokkan mana teknologinya dan mana tujuan dari teknologi itu digunakan, gitu ya. Nanti kalian bakal paham kok kalau nengok di bawah, oke? Okay? Okay, so we will see the data here. Okay, here we have three data and three technology. So the first table, the first part of the table is the maximum length of sequence fragments. Oh, before we read this, you have to know about next generation sequencing. Okay, you have to know about this. What's the procedure? Okay, you have to know the purpose and the techniques in detail about the next generation sequencing. So I have the link in the description. Okay, so I have the link in my description, okay, below. So you can click that link. You can click that link and you'll find that the link will introduce you to the next generation sequencing, okay? That's a video link from YouTube. So you can watch that and come back here, okay? Jadi sebelum kita kesini ya, kalian perlu tahu tentang next generation sequencing. Jadi kalian perlu tahu tentang ini ya. Dan ada linknya ya. Linknya di deskripsi. Di deskripsi nomor 1 itu ada link, kalian tinggal tekan, nanti ada videonya. Dan videonya itu cukup bagus dan itu menjelaskan bagaimana prosedur dari next generation sequencing, oke? Okay? So, we have the first data here, the maximum length of the sequence. So, in next generation sequencing, we have to cut the long DNA into chunks, okay? So, if we have a very long DNA, we have to cut them, okay? We have to cut. And every single cut cannot more than 900 base pair for the Sanger sequencing, okay? Each part cannot more than 900 base pair long, okay? And different technology have different maximum length, okay? So you can see here. Now, error rate. We have 1 in 1000 base pair error rate. So the error is so low, okay? And this is moderate or medium. And this is high. High error rate, okay? So you see 1 in 10 base pair is error, okay? So this is very high. Now, the last data here, total number of base sequence per day, okay? So for Sanger sequencing, we only can sequence 1 fragment a day. So this is very slow, okay? Very, very slow technology. But if we see the Pacific Bioscience, it can sequence more than 8,000 fragments here. Okay, so this is very fast. Okay. Nah, jadi ya, kalian bisa lihat di sini ya, data pertama itu. itu adalah panjang maksimum dari sequence-nya, dari fragmennya maksud sensei. Jadi kalau kita punya DNA yang panjang, kita nggak bisa langsung sequence gitu. Kita harus potong dulu, ya. Kita potong. Nah, satu potongan ini nggak boleh lebih panjang dari 900 base pair untuk yang Sanger. Tapi tiap teknik itu punya panjang maksimal yang berbeda-beda, ya. Jadi nggak boleh lebih panjang dari ini. Kalau kurang, boleh tentunya, oke? Lalu kita ke error rate. Jadi ini adalah seberapa banyak sih errornya terjadi, gitu. Jadi yang Sanger itu hanya 1 dari 1000 base pair yang error. Jadi ini sangat low, ya. Sangat rendah kemungkinan error. Sementara yang ini itu medium. Yang ini itu high. Oke, jadi ini sangat tinggi sekali tingkat errornya. 1 dari 10 dia error. Dan sekarang data terakhir. Ini adalah total bahasa yang disequence per hari. Nah, jadi untuk Sanger kita cuma bisa mensequence 1 fragmen per hari. Atau 900 base pair di sini, ya. Dan ini kan sangat lambat. Jadi ini sangat slow. Oke, teknologi yang terlalu lambat. Sementara yang Pacific Bioscience itu bisa mensequence lebih dari 80.000 fragmen per hari. Jadi ini sangat cepat. Oke? Nah, itu aja yang bisa kita ambil dari data ini. Now, we can continue to the statements. The first statement is, Illumina technology is best for finding new single nucleotide variations. So, here we can see that the statement. Is Illumina technology the best for finding single nucleotide variations? If we want to find a single nucleotide, we have to use the low or medium error rate. Okay? Because a single nucleotide is very, very tiny. So, if we want to detect a very tiny single nucleotide, we have to use the low or medium error rate. Okay, we cannot use specific bioscience because the error rate is so high. Okay, so we cannot use that. Now, in the patient's genomes, okay, we can see here in the patient's genome. Okay, the patient's genome is 100,000 genomes. So this is very long. Because the genomes is very long, we cannot use Sanger sequencing. Why? Because Sanger is too slow. Okay, too slow. We cannot use this. So Illumina is the best. So this is true. Okay, the first statement is true. Okay. Jadi ya, di sini. Statement pertama itu Illumina itu adalah yang terbaik untuk mencari variasi satu nukleotida. Oke, ya. Variasi satu nukleotida. Jadi kalau kita mau melihat variasi satu nukleotida itu kan sangat kecil, ya. Kita harus memakai teknik yang error rate-nya itu low atau medium. Kenapa, Sensei? Karena kalau kita pakai yang ini, ya, kita pakai yang Pacific, errornya kan banyak nih, errornya sangat tinggi. Jadi yang nggak kedeteksi satu nukleotida itu nggak bakal kedeteksi karena errornya terlalu banyak gitu, ya. Jadi kita nggak bisa pakai ini. Nah, kita lanjutkan kata-katanya. In the patient's genome, jadi di genom pasien. Kalian ingat tadi genom pasiennya itu ada 100.000, ya. 100.000 genom, jadi itu terlalu panjang. Kita nggak bisa memakai Sanger sequencing karena ini kan hanya satu fragmen per hari. Jadi terlalu lambat, ya, kita nggak bisa pakai ini. Kita pasti pakai yang Illumina karena lebih cepat lah, gitu, ya. Jadi Illumina yang terbaik. Jadi statementnya true, oke? Alias benar, ya. Oke. The next statement is Pacific Bioscience technology is best for assessing transcriptional change by RNA sequencing. So here we have transcriptional change, oke? So there are two types of transcriptional chains. The first is point mutation. Okay, point mutation or single nucleotide variation. Okay, this is the same meaning. Okay, the same. And the second is frameshift mutation. Okay, what's the difference, Sensei? Okay, so if we have the original RNA like A, U, G, C, A, U, this is just example, okay? So if there is a point mutation, it will become A, maybe G here, and then G, and then C, and then A, and then U. I'm sorry. And if there is frame shift mutation, we have to add a nucleotide, okay, a single nucleotide. So we can insert A, maybe, yeah, A, okay, insert A here and continue U G C, okay, U G C U G C A U A U, okay, this is frame shift, the arrow. Wait, like this. This is the point mutation. This is the frame shift mutation. Okay, so here we can see that the point mutation only change a single nucleotide. Okay, so if you remember that ribosome read RNA in triplets, right? Codon. So we have to find the codon. Here the first codon. This is just my example, okay? This is the second codon. And this will be the third codon, etc., okay? So, if there is point mutation, it only changes a single amino acid here. AUG becomes AGG. Only one amino acid change, okay? The second amino acid is the same. If there is frame shift mutation, the first amino acid will change, okay? AUG becomes AAU, and the second is also changed. Okay, CAU become GCA. So, from here to the downstream will be wrong, okay? From here to the downstream will be wrong. All of them will be wrong if there is a frame shift mutation occurs. Okay, so if there is a frame shift mutation, we can use the Pacific Bioscience. Why? Because the error rate is so high. If the error rate is so high, it only can detect big changes. Okay, it only can detect a big changes. Why? Because the error rate is so high. It cannot detect a point mutation, okay? It cannot detect a point mutation. It cannot detect a single nucleotide variation, okay? So, frame shift, it can detect a frame shift, but a point mutation, it cannot, okay? It cannot detect a point mutation. So, Pacific Bioscience is not the best for this. Okay, so we have the answer here. So, okay, this is false. This is not the best. Okay, jadi katanya di sini Pacific Bioscience itu paling bagus untuk mendeteksi transcriptional change. Ya, transcriptional change ini kita tahu ada dua jenis ya. Yang pertama itu ada point mutation atau perubahan di satu nukleotida, ya ini sama ya, ini maksudnya ini. Dan ada yang kedua itu namanya adalah frame shift mutation. Okay, so bahasa Indonesia. Jadi apa bedanya, Sensei? Gampang ya, misalnya ini ada A U G A C A, ini hanya contoh ya. Nah, misalnya ada point mutation, dia bakal berubah jadi misalnya A, C, G, A, C, A ya. Yang berubah itu adalah U jadi C. Tapi kalau ada frame shift mutation, dia itu kita sisipkan satu nukleotida. Misalnya A kita sisipkan ya. Jadi A, A, baru sambung. U, G, A, C, A, oke? Okay? U, G, A, C, A. Nah, kalian bisa mengingatkan kalau ribosom itu membaca triplet kodon ya. Jadi dia membaca triplet kodon. Ini triplet pertama. Ini triplet kedua. Yang A ini bakal jadi bagian dari triplet ketiga, oke? Ini kan ada kepanjangannya lagi ya, ke sana ada lagi gitu. Ini hanya bagian kecilnya yang Sensei tulis. Jadi, kalau point mutation, dia hanya mengubah asam amino satu biji aja yang diubah. AUG menjadi ACG, ya. Yang ini kan tetap sama nih, ACACA. Sama ya, jadi ACACA. Tetap sama, yang seterusnya ini aman-aman aja gitu. Tapi, kalau yang di frame shift mutation, yang satunya berubah ya, AUG jadi AAU. Yang keduanya juga berubah. ACA jadi GAC. Jadi salah juga. Dan seterusnya, downstream ya, seterusnya dia bakal salah semua. Salah semua. Dan kalau dia salah semua, bisa kita deteksi pakai Pacific Bioscience. Bisa ya. Kenapa? Karena error rate-nya itu tinggi. Kalau error rate-nya tinggi, dia hanya bisa mendeteksi perubahan besar-besaran. Oke, jadi dia hanya bisa mendeteksi perubahan besar-besaran. Sama seperti yang frame shift. Ini kan salah semua nih. Jadi dia bisa deteksi pakai Pacific. Tapi kalau hanya point mutation ya, hanya point mutation, dia nggak bisa deteksi karena error rate-nya itu terlalu tinggi. Ya, jadi nggak akurat. Kita nggak bisa mendeteksi point mutation. Jadi Pacific itu bukan yang terbaik. Oke, kita nggak bisa pakai Pacific. Karena kan dia cuma bisa mendeteksi frame shift, nggak bisa mendeteksi point mutation, oke? Sah, sah. Oke, now, the third statement. Pacific Bioscience technology is based for finding rearrangement of chunks of DNA in the patient's genome. This is definitely true. Why? Because, like what I explained before, Pacific Bioscience can detect a frame shift mutation, and frame shift mutation will rearrange the chunks of DNA, okay? A big chunks of DNA will be rearranged by the frame shift mutation. So if there is a big change in the DNA, a big chunks DNA is rearranged, we can use the Pacific Bioscience like I said before, okay? This is true. Jadi yang ketiga ini katanya Pacific Bioscience itu paling bagus untuk melihat ya rearrangement atau pensejajaran ulang dari setumpuk DNA. Jadi ini benar ya. Pensejajaran ulang ini sama dengan yang tadi frame shift mutation ya. Jadi dia diulang, dia kodonnya itu berubah semua. Ke bawah itu berubah semua kodonnya. Jadi rearrangement terjadi. Dan kita bisa mendeteksi frame shift pakai Pacific Bioscience. Jadi ini benar ya. Kalau hanya frame shift, kita bisa pakai Pacific. Mantap Pacific, oke? Okay? Now, the last statement. Sanger sequencing is best for validating sequencing result before using patient's genetic information to guide clinical interventions. This is definitely true. Why? Because if we only need to validate the sequence, we have to use the higher, okay? Error rate, lower. The lowest error rate. Because we want to validate. Okay, we want to validate. We have to use the lowest error rate. Okay, the most specific technology. Okay, so we have to use Sanger. This is true. Okay, jadi katanya ya, yang di statement terakhir ini, Sanger itu yang terbaik untuk memvalidasi. Itu benar ya. Jadi karena Sanger ini sangat kecil kemungkinan errornya, jadi paling akurat dan dia paling enak untuk sekedar memvalidasi gitu ya. Karena kan cuma validasi doang nih. Oke, okay, so the answers are true, false, true, true. Jadi jawabannya adalah benar, salah, benar, benar. Oke, okay? To the next question. I'm so sorry if my English was so broken, and it will be broken also in the next question. I'm so sorry about this. So this is the second questions. You can read this, okay? If you want. You have to pause the video if you want to read this. I'll jump to the tree, okay? I'll jump to the tree. Here. This is the evolutionary or relation tree, okay? Nah, jadi tadi ada soal ya. Kalau kalian mau baca, boleh di-pause dulu videonya. Tapi sensei bakal lompat langsung ke pohon ini, okay? Karena di soal kurang penting gitu. So, we can see here, the dinosaurs are closely related to humans. This is very, very weird. Okay, really, really weird. Why? Because we know dinosaurs are closely related to aves. Okay, to chicken. Okay, chicken is the most close. How to say this? Dinosaurs are very closely related to chicken or aves, not to humans. Okay, we all know that this is a common sense. Okay, so I'll change to Indonesia first. Jadi di sini kalian bisa lihat ya, katanya dinosaurus itu dekat dengan human, dengan manusia. Ini tentu aja sangat aneh. Kenapa bisa dinosaurus dekat sama manusia? Ini sangat-sangat aneh ya. Kita tahu dinosaurus itu dekat dengan aves atau ayam ya. Jadi ayam itu adalah yang paling dekat dengan dinosaurus. Jadi bukan manusia ya. Kita tuh jauh dari dinosaurus. Oke, kita nggak dekat sama dinosaurus kekerabatannya. Oke, so we continue. Oh, this is the statements. So, the first statement is, when working with ancient sample, it's easier to recover DNA sequence from mitochondrial gene than a nuclear gene of the same length. This is very true. Why? Because we have more mitochondria than nuclear gene, okay? So, if we have only one nuclear, okay, nuclear, this is the nucleus, okay, the nucleus. We only have one nucleus here, but we have many mitochondria. Okay, many mitochondria in one cell, in a single cell. So it's easier to recover a DNA from mitochondria. Why? Because mitochondria are just so abundant in our cell. Okay, so this is true. Jadi ya, katanya di statement pertama ini, kalau ada ancient sample ya, atau sampel purba, itu lebih gampang mencari DNA dari mitokondria daripada DNA dari inti sel. Tentu saja benar. Kenapa? Karena kita cuma punya satu inti sel. Oke? Okay? Cuma punya satu inti sel, nukleus. Tapi kita punya banyak mitokondria. Oke? Okay? Jadi tentu lebih gampang mencari DNA mitokondria daripada DNA nukleus. Oke? Okay? Jadi itu dia jawabannya, benar. Karena lebih banyak mitokondria. So, the second statement is, it's better to sequence very long DNA than a very short fragments. This is, of course, false. Because, in reality, it's very, very hard to find a very long DNA, okay? This is unlikely. Unlikely. This is so hard to find. Okay, because DNA will be degraded over time. Okay, will be degraded over time. So we cannot find a very long DNA completely. Okay, so usually we only have the short fragments. We only see the short fragments. Okay, but why we use short fragments? First, because it's easier to obtain, and the second, we can see the how I say that? We can see the conserve, okay? Conserve sequence. Like the mitochondrial DNA, okay? Mitochondrial genes. Like mitochondrial genes have a conserve sequence, okay? In many species, it has the same conserve sequence or similar conserve sequence. Okay, so we can compare the ancient sample, okay, the ancient sample to the animals we have today. Okay, we compare the conserved sequence of the short fragments. Okay, so we find the conserved sequence in the short fragments and we compare the ancient sequence to the animals we have today or the data we have today in gene bank, like that. Okay, so we use the very short fragment. We not use a very long DNA because that's so hard to obtain. Okay, jadi di sini katanya ya lebih bagus mensequence DNA yang sangat panjang daripada fragmen-fragmen. Ini salah tentunya, karena DNA yang sangat panjang itu sangat susah didapatkan, sangat susah, karena kan DNA itu terdegradasi ya, sepanjang waktu dia terdegradasi, makin lama makin hancur, jadi lebih gampang nyari yang pendek, fragmen. Dan kenapa kita pakai yang pendek? Karena kita bisa melihat conserve sequence-nya, ya, conserve sequence. Jadi kita bisa lihat yang terkonservasi. Misalnya ada mitokondria DNA ya, DNA mitokondria. Dia ada bagiannya yang terkonservasi. Jadi kita bisa melihat bagian yang terkonservasi itu dan kita bandingkan dengan data yang kita punya sekarang ya. Misalnya ini yang hewan purba ya, yang ancient sample. Kita bisa bandingkan dengan hewan yang kita punya sekarang atau data-data yang kita punya sekarang. Apa yang kita bandingkan? Conserve sequence-nya. Jadi semakin mirip conserve sequence-nya, maka mereka semakin dekat kekerabatannya. Gitu ya. Jadi kita bisa melihat dari conserve sequence. Oke. Set. Set. Oke. The third statement is adding. I don't know how to pronounce this. Adding a DNA fragment of a known sequence could show whether or not sample contain polymerase inhibitors. This is so true. Because if we have an ancient sample here, okay, this is the ancient sample, we don't really know the sequence, okay? We don't know the sequence because this is an ancient sample. We don't know, okay? We don't know the sequence. So, how to detect a polymerase inhibitor? We mix them, okay? We mix them with our known sample, okay? This is known sample, maybe ATGC, maybe, or oh, this is too obvious, GGA. Okay, this is just my example. We mix them together, okay? We mix them together here, and we add a polymerase. Okay, we add some drops of polymerase here. If we see that ATGGA becomes multiplied, okay, is multiplied, I mean, if the ATGGA is multiplied, maybe first we have 500, maybe 500, and it becomes 1000, okay, in this mixture. The ATGGA becomes 1000. So that means it has no inhibitors, okay? It has no inhibitors. But if it only becomes like 700 or something like this, okay? It indicates there is some concentration of inhibitors, okay? So if it's not completely multiplied, so it means that the mixture have some inhibitors in it, okay? From the ancient sample, okay? First, we have to make sure this without inhibitor, okay? Without inhibitor, we have to make sure this. So if there is an indication of inhibitors, it will comes from the ancient sample, okay? So yes, we can use the these techniques. Okay, I hope you can understand me. I'm so sorry that my English is so broken. I'm so sorry about that. I just want to teach some of my students and overseas also. Jadi di ketiga ini ya, pernyataan ketiga, katanya menambahkan fragmen dari sequence yang udah diketahui bisa menunjukkan apakah sampel purba itu memiliki inhibitor. Oke ya, ini benar bisa dilakukan. Misalnya kita punya sampel purba, ya, ini yang sampel purba atau ancient. Jadi kalau kita campur, kita kan belum tahu nih sequennya apa, kita nggak tahu. Kita jadi nggak bisa mastiin. Jadi kita campur dia dengan yang udah kita ketahui. Oke ya, ini yang kita udah tahu. Misalnya ATGCA misalnya. Nah, kalau kita campur, ya, kita campur di wadah dan kita tambahkan polymerase, oke? Kalau ATGCA itu menjadi 1000 ya, misalnya awalnya itu 500 deh, menjadi 1000 di dalam campuran ini, berarti nggak ada inhibitor, ya kan? Nggak ada inhibitor. Tapi kalau misalnya dia hanya 700 misalnya, ATGCA ini misalnya hanya 700, berarti itu mengindikasikan bahwa ada inhibitor dalam konsentrasi tertentu, oke? Dan kita harus memastikan kalau ini murni, ya, yang sampel ini murni. Jadi kalaupun ada inhibitor terdeteksi di sini, maka itu berasal dari sampel purbanya, ya. Nah, jadi ya kita bisa pakai teknik ini, oke? Sah, sah, sah. Oke, the last statement is this dinosaur fossil extract is likely to contain contaminating DNA. This is definitely true because we see that why the dinosaurs are closely related to humans. Why? That makes no sense, okay? So, why that happens? It contain a contaminating DNA, okay? Maybe comes from the professor hands, maybe? From our hands. If we touch the sample, okay? If we touch the sample, and we not sterilize our hands, our DNA may be get to the ancient sample, and that makes our sequence error. Okay, so wash out your hands during practicum. Okay, jadi katanya di sini fosil dinosaurus ini itu mungkin mengandung DNA kontaminasi, itu benar ya. Karena tadi aneh ya, masa dinosaurus dekat sama manusia, itu aneh banget. Kenapa? Mungkin ya tangan profesornya itu nyentuh sampelnya tanpa desinfeksi. Jadi sel tangannya itu mungkin masuk ya ke dalam sampel, jadi terkontaminasi sehingga terbacanya sampel manusia, makanya dekat sama manusia ya. Jadi terkontaminasi, oke? So the answers are true, false, true, true. Jadi jawabannya adalah benar, salah, benar, benar. Okay, to the next question. So here we have the third question about the microarray. So you have to know what microarray first. Okay, so I have the link in description. Okay, you can click that link and watch the video. Okay, that will explain what the microarray actually are. Okay. Actually is, I mean. So you can read this and pause the video. But I'll jump to the picture, okay? So we have a large B cell lymphocyte here, okay? What about... Okay, there are two subtype of DLBCL. Okay, there are two subtype. From the first picture, we can see the distinct difference between them. Okay, you can see this is the first subtype. This is the second subtype. Okay, you can see they are distinctly separate here. Okay. So you can see the first subtype, okay, the first subtype and the second subtype. We can see here this expression around here very low, okay, low. The expressions are very low here and high here. But the second type is the apocyte, okay, the opposite. So it has a higher expression here and lower expression here, okay? So they are opposite to each other. Okay? And from the second picture we can see here the x subset, okay? We don't know which one is x, which one is y, we don't know. So here we only see the x and y. The subtype x is saver, I think. And the y subtype is deadlier, okay? Deadlier. Oh, deadlier, I mean. Deadlier. The y subtype. Okay? So, that's what we got from the data. Jadi ya, kalian bisa baca ini dulu. Tapi sensei bakal langsung lompat ke gambar. Karena di sini dia hanya mengatakan bahwa ada dua subtipe dari DLBCL. Oke. Okay? Kalian bisa lihat di sini ada dua perbedaan ya, udah jelas nih. Nah, ini ada yang pertama, ini ada yang kedua. Oke. Okay? Yang pertama dan yang kedua. Di sini kita bisa lihat yang pertama itu bagian sini ya. Sangat rendah ekspresinya, sementara yang ini tinggi. Yang ini tinggi, yang ini rendah. Jadi kebalikan ya mereka ini. Dan di sini ada grafik yang subtipe X itu lebih sehat lah. Tapi yang subtipe Y itu lebih poten, lebih berbahaya karena banyak yang mati, gitu ya. Nah, jadi itu yang bisa kita dapat dari data. Next to the statements. Okay. The data roll out patient survival rate being determined by difference in gene expression between the DLBCL subtypes. This is definitely false because the data rule out. Okay, you can see here, rule out. No, they are actually connected to each other. Okay, they are actually connected to each other. This picture, we can see here it has two subtype, and here in this graph. We also can see here that this graph also contain two subtype, okay? 1, 2, 1, 2. So, they are related to each other, okay? So, if the statement is roll out, that false, okay? Not the statement is rolled out, so this is false because they actually connected to each other. Okay, they are related to each other. Nah, jadi katanya di sini datanya itu tidak mencerminkan ya, data ekspresi ini dia nggak mencerminkan survival rate. Okay, jadi katanya yang ekspresi ini, nah, yang gambar ekspresi ini tidak mencerminkan survival rate. Apakah benar? Salah dong. Kenapa salah sensei? Karena ini udah jelas ya. Kita bisa lihat di sini tadi ada dua subtipe. Ini subtipe 1, ini subtipe 2. Sementara di sini juga ada dua subtipe ya, subtipe 1, subtipe 2. Jadi udah jelas di sini ada dua subtipe. Jadi keduanya itu saling mencerminkan satu sama lain, oke? Okay? Datanya ini saling terhubung. Kalau katanya tidak mencerminkan, ya, ini katanya data tidak mencerminkan. Jadi salah ya. Mereka mencerminkan satu sama lain. Oke? Okay? So, the second statement is, gene expression data suggests there are two major subtype. That's true, okay? So, as I said before, we have two subtype if we see the expression data here, okay? So, back to Indonesia. Nah, jadi katanya, data ekspresi ini menunjukkan ada dua major subtipe. Benar ya? Tadi udah jelas ya, ada dua subtipe. The third statement is, measuring the expression of single gene is sufficient to distinguish subtype of DLBCL. This is of course false. Because if you watch the video, okay, the video I mentioned earlier, this is not a single gene, okay, this is genes, multiple genes. So if we have the container here, okay, this is the container. It have many wells, okay? Many wells. Okay, many wells. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and many, many, many little wells. Okay? Many little wells. And if you have the side view, okay, the side view will be like this. Okay, this is the wells, this is the wells, this is the wells, this is the side view, okay, side view. So it contains many wells. So this is many small wells, okay, many small wells. Okay, so if we want to distinguish them, we have to examine many genes, okay, many genes. We cannot use only a single gene, okay, we cannot use only a single gene. We have to find multiple genes, okay, so that's why the statement is false, okay. Nah, jadi katanya menentukan ekspresi dari satu gen itu udah cukup untuk membedakan kedua subtipe. Itu salah. Ya, kenapa salah? Karena kalau kalian nonton video sensei yang tadi sensei suruh tonton ya, itu sebenarnya yang microarray ini ya, dia itu punya banyak sumur kecil. Ya, sumur kecil. Jadi kalau kalian lihat dari samping itu begini. Ini sumurnya, dan seterusnya. Jadi sumur-sumur kecil gitu. Jadi ini semua sumur kecil ya, kecil-kecil. Satu sumur satu gen. Jadi kalau kalian mau membedakan keduanya, kalian harus melihat banyak gen ya. Ini kan banyak gen yang kita lihat nih. Baru bisa dibedakan. Kalau cuma satu gen, kita nggak bisa bedain. Ya, kita harus cari banyak gen. Oke, okay, so itulah kenapa jawabannya salah. Oke, okay, false. Now, the last statement is, each subtype of DLBCL has an equal number of relatively upregulated versus downregulated genes. Oke, okay, up versus down. Oke, okay, we can see here. Oke, okay, up. This is the upregulated, okay? This is upregulated, so only one of the third, okay? One of the three parts. One of the three parts is the upregulated, okay? This is only one from the three, okay? One upon three. But in the second subtype, okay? This is the first, this is the second. We can see the upregulated is 2 upon 3, okay, 2 upon 3, so they are not equal, okay, they are not equal, the upregulated are not equal, they are not equal, I mean, okay, this is false. Jadi katanya di sini setiap subtipe itu punya perbandingan upregulated dengan downregulated yang sama. Gitu ya, apakah sama perbandingan up dan downnya? Nah, bagian sini dan bagian sini. Bagian sini yang up itu yang ini ya, yang ekspresinya tinggi. Jadi ini hanya 1/3, ya kan? 1/3. Sementara yang ini itu 2/3. Oke, 2/3. Jadi nggak sama ya, nggak equal gitu. Jadi nggak sama. Ini 2/3, satu lagi 1/3. Jadi ya salah kalau dia bilang sama, ya. Ini kan katanya setara. Jadi salah ya, mereka nggak setara, mereka beda. So, the answers are false, true, false, false. Jadi jawabannya adalah false, jadi jawabannya adalah salah, benar, salah, salah. Oke, okay. To the next number. So, this is the fourth question. A plasmid. Oh, you can pause the video. You can pause the video and read the opening here. But I'll jump to the picture, okay? So, here we have a plasmid, okay? As we know, this is a common sense that plasmid will go to either here and here. Okay? The plasmid replication fork will go here and here, okay? They go in both direction. I'm sorry. They will go in both direction, to the left and to the right, okay? So the RFP gene and GFP gene will be replicated equally, okay? So red RR stands for red. G stands for green, okay? So, they will have the equal amount of GFP and RFP. As we see here, they are linear. Okay, they are linear. So, if the red intensity increase, the green intensity will also increase. If the red intensity decrease, the green intensity will also decrease. Okay, so they are linear. Why they are linear? Because the replication fork go to this direction and this direction simultaneously. Okay, jadi kalian bisa baca soalnya yang di atas ya tadi. Kalian bisa pause videonya, baca pembukaannya. Tapi Sensei bakal langsung bahas yang gambar. Jadi sini ada plasmid. Kalian udah pasti tahu ya, plasmid itu geraknya itu ke sini dan ke sini, garpu replikasinya. Ya, jadi bergeraknya tuh ke sini dan ke sini secara bersamaan. Jadi yang RFP dan GFP ini bakal setara ya, sama-sama jumlahnya tuh bakal sama. G itu adalah hijau ya. R itu adalah red atau merah. Seperti yang bisa kita lihat di grafik ya, mereka linear. Linear. Jadi semakin besar intensitas merah, semakin besar juga intensitas hijau. Semakin kecil intensitas merah, semakin kecil juga intensitas hijau. Jadi mereka itu linear karena replikasi garpu replikasinya itu ke sini dan ke sini secara bersamaan, gitu ya. Itu pemahaman umum lah. Oke. Okay? So, the first statement is replicating plasmid have an equal number of red and green. This is of course false. Why? Because as I mentioned before, they have equal numbers of red and green. Okay, they are equal because the replication fork go to left and right simultaneously. Okay, simultaneously. So they are equal. Okay, jadi katanya di sini jumlah yang merah dan hijau itu nggak bakal setara. Ya salah dong ya, karena tadi ya Sensei jelasin ya, garpu replikasinya itu ke kanan dan ke kiri secara bersamaan. Jadi mereka bakal sama jumlahnya, setara jumlahnya ya, rasionya bakal sama. Jadi kalau katanya nggak sama ya, ini katanya nggak sama, jadi salah. Harusnya sama. Oke? Okay? The second statement is, on average, cells in region A contain more replication factor than those in region B. Okay, so we can see here, region A only in this area, the region B in this area. Okay, so we can see here, the region A will have lower, okay, lower replication factors. Okay, why? Because the intensity is also low. If the intensity low, the replication factors will be low. Okay, if the intensity low, of course the replication factor is also low, because without replication factors it cannot replicate more. Okay, it cannot replicate more. So A is lower, not more. Okay, not more. This is false. A is less. Okay, contain less replication factors, not more. Okay, that's false. Jadi katanya di sini ya, di region A itu lebih banyak replikasi, faktor replikasinya daripada yang B. Kita lihat di sini ya. Yang region A itu rendah intensitasnya, yang region B itu tinggi. Jadi kalau rendah intensitasnya, berarti faktor replikasinya juga rendah. Ya kan? Kalau faktor replikasinya rendah, udah pasti intensitasnya juga rendah. Karena faktor replikasi itu dibutuhkan untuk menambah intensitas, gitu ya. Jadi kalau dibilangnya lebih banyak, itu salah ya. Harusnya lebih sedikit, ya, less atau lebih sedikit. Alias lebih rendah di region A. Jadi itu salah ya. So, the third statement is, on average, cell in region A contain more transcription factors than in region B. This is also false. As the same with the second statement, replication factors and transcription factors will increase intensity, increase the intensity. Okay, they will increase the intensity, not decrease the intensity. We can see here region A is less, okay, less. So it also have less transcription factor, okay? So this is also false. Nah, jadi yang ketiga ya, katanya itu region A itu lebih banyak transkripsi, faktor transkripsinya. Ya, tentu salah lah ya. Sama seperti alasannya seperti yang tadi ya. Faktor transkripsi ini bakal menambah intensitas. Jadi kalau katanya A lebih banyak faktor transkripsi, harusnya A itu lebih tinggi intensitasnya. Tapi di sini A malah lebih rendah. Ya kan? Jadi tentu saja itu salah. So, the last statement is increasing the activity of transcription factor is expected to increase the number of cell containing equal amount of green and red. This is true. Why? Because if the transcription factor is increased, okay, is increased. If the transcription factors are increased, the green and red fluorescence will increase equally. Okay, will also increase equally. So this is true. Okay, equal. They will increase equally. Nah, jadi katanya ya, kalau kita menambah aktivitas dari faktor transkripsi, dia bakal menambah warna merah dan warna hijau setara, ya. Jadi makin banyak merah, makin banyak hijau. Ya, tentu benar ya. Seperti yang saya jelaskan tadi, mereka itu bakal setara, ya. Merah dan hijaunya bakal setara. So, the answers are false, 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 true. Jadi jawabannya adalah salah, 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 benar. Oke? Okay? To the next question. The fifth question. Oke. Okay. So, as usual, you can pause the video and read the opening. But I'll jump to the picture, okay? So you have to know that H2A and H2AZ are histones. They are histones, and histones will inhibit gene expression. Okay, histone will inhibit gene expression. So, we will see the picture, okay? So, we have two types of Arabidopsis. Here we have the colder environment and hotter environment or warmer environment. So, in the colder environment, the bound is higher, okay? The bound is higher. So what that mean? What does it mean? So if the bound is high, the DNA will be coiled around the histone, and it will inhibit the expression. As we can see here, the Arabidopsis is smaller here because the bound is also higher, okay? Is higher. And this is the opposite, okay? This is the opposite. It has a fewer bound, so it has more expression, okay? Nah, jadi di sini kalian bisa baca tadi ya soalnya kalau kalian mau pause videonya. Dan kalian harus tahu di sini kalau H2A dan H2AZ itu adalah histone. Histone itu bakal menghambat ekspresi ya, karena dia bakal menggulung DNA. Oke. Okay? Nah, di sini kalian bisa lihat ada dua tipe ya Arabidopsis. Jadi, yang pertama itu lingkungannya lebih dingin, yang kedua lebih hangat. Jadi, di tempat yang lebih dingin itu ikatannya lebih tinggi, berarti dia itu terlilit di histone sehingga ekspresinya rendah. Kalau ekspresinya rendah, tumbuhannya lebih kecil, ya kan? Bisa lihat di sini. Dan kalau lebih hangat tentu dia lebih sedikit ikatannya, ya lebih sedikit ikatannya, berarti ekspresinya tinggi dan tumbuhannya ikutan tumbuh gitu ya. Sah. Now, the first statement. Sah. Increasing temperature increase pro-flowering gene expression. This is true. As we can see here, increasing temperature will increase a flowering gene expression, okay? We can see here the flower is bigger than this. So, the gene expression is higher. Okay? Or increase. The expression is higher or increase. Okay? This is true. Jadi katanya ya, nih, di apa peningkatan suhu itu bakal meningkatkan ekspresi gen yang mendukung perbungaan. Itu benar ya, karena kalian bisa lihat di sini, kalau temperaturnya naik, dia bakal berbunga. Ya, kalian lihat di sini. Nah, dia bakal berbunga. Jadi itu benar ya. Jadi meningkatkan ekspresi gen untuk berbunga. Ya, jadi itu benar. Now, the second statement. H2AZ enhance gene expression. This is definitely false. Why? Because H2AZ is histone. Or are histones. Histones will inhibit gene expression. Okay, not enhance. They will inhibit gene expression. Okay. Nah, jadi katanya di sini H2AZ itu bakal meningkatkan ekspresi gen, tentu aja salah. Karena kita tahu dia adalah histon. Histon bakal menghambat, bukan meningkatkan, ya. Jadi salah. Now, the third statement. Temperature move the location to which H2AZ bind in the genome. We have no data about that. Okay, we have no data about that. About the movement of histone, okay? Movement of the histone. We have no data here. So, this is false. Why? Because we have no data about the movement. Okay? Jadi, di sini katanya, temperatur bakal menggerakkan atau memindahkan lokasi dari histonnya. Itu salah ya. Karena di sini kita nggak bisa melihat ada data pergerakan ya. Nggak ada di sini data pergerakan. Coba kalian baca deh. Ya, nggak ada ya. Jadi di sini nggak ada data pergerakan, jadi ya salah. Nggak ada datanya, oke? Okay. Now, the last statement is, plants that flower early may have increased H2A occupancy in this gene before flowering. This is, of course, false. Because if the H2A increase, it will inhibit flower. Flowering, okay? It will inhibit flowering. That will not flower early, okay? It will let the flower will be late, okay? Will be late. If the H2AZ increase, the flower will be late, not early, okay? This is false. Okay, so I'll back to Indonesia. Nah, jadi di sini ya, katanya tumbuhan yang berbunga awal itu lebih meningkat H2AZ-nya. Jadi itu salah ya. Karena kalau H2AZ-nya itu meningkat, bunganya bakal telat. Ya, bunganya bakal telat. Karena tadi kan dia histon, dia menghambat. Jadi dia bakal telat bunganya, dihambat ya kan, sama histon ini. Tapi kalau dia di sini bilang berbunga lebih awal, jadi salah dong. Ya, jadi salah. Dia harusnya telat ya. So, the answers are true, false, false, false. Jadi jawabannya adalah benar, salah, salah, salah. Oke? Okay? To the next question. This is the sixth question. About the gene silencing. Oke. Okay. So, GFP was inserted into plants. Okay, GFP, the green fluorescence protein. Okay, green fluorescence protein. The plants were treated with RNAS. So, if you heard RNA, siRNA, RNAs, and RNAi. These all is inhibitor. Okay, these all are. I'm sorry. These all are inhibitor. Inhibitors, I mean. They will inhibit the expression of the gene, but the mechanism slightly different. Okay. Now, with silent GFP, okay, silence the GFP, and were allowed to set the seed. Okay, they allowed to set the seed. So this is the parent. This is the seed or child. RNAs are not present in the next generation, so RNAs will be added here, not here, okay, not here, only in the parent's genome, to the parent's genome, I mean, only to the parent's genome. The treatment RNA sequence was complementary to either promoter or protein coding sequence of GSP or random. The parent's plants, their progeny and culture were I cannot pronounce that under a UV light. Okay, so this is what we got. As we can see here, okay, this is good. If the plant is not modified, okay, this is unmodified, the child will be unmodified too. But if the parent is modified with RNAs, okay, RNAs modified with RNAs in random, okay, here they have GFP, okay, here they have GFP, and the RNAs is random, okay, is random in this parent, okay, the binding site is random, okay, the binding site is random. So if the binding site is random, it will not inhibit, okay, if the binding site is random, it will not inhibit GFP, so it becomes green, because it will not inhibit the green. Okay, if the binding site binds to promoter, okay, promoter, if the RNA bind to the promoter, it will decrease the GFP, okay, decrease GFP. You can see here less green. If the RNAs bind to protein coding, okay, to the protein coding, it will inhibit GFP. As you can see here, it becomes darker, okay, because the GFP is inhibited. And now, if the parents is random, it will Okay, if the binding site is random, it will inherit, okay, the child will be inherit the GFP, okay, so here GFP inherited, okay, GFP inherited. But if the RNAs bind to the promoter, it will not be inherited here, okay? You can see there is no GFP here. So if the RNAs bind to promoter, it will not inherit the GFP, okay? No GFP for the child. And if RNAs is bind to the protein coding, it will inherit, okay, inherit the GFP gene, okay, GFP inherited. Inherit. Okay? So, but why sensei the parents is darker? This because the RNAS inhibit the GFP, okay? Only inhibit the GFP, not mutate, okay? Not mutate. Okay? Only inhibit the GFP, not mutate it. So, it can be inherited, okay? It can be inherited because the gene is still here, but it's not expressed, okay? It's not expressed in these parents. The gene is still here, okay? So that's what we got, okay? Maybe you want to screenshot this. I'm sorry if the screen so messy. I'm so sorry. So that's what we got, okay? Jadi di sini ya, dia itu bakal memasukkan GFP ya. Jadi tiga ini dia bakal dimasukkan GFP. GFP itu yang warna hijau ya, gen warna hijau gitulah GFP. Dan dia bakal ditambahkan RNAS. Jadi ya, kalau kalian pernah dengar miRNA, cRNA, RNAi, RNAS, ini semua itu penghambat. Ya, ini semua penghambat walaupun sebenarnya mereka ini punya mekanisme yang beda-beda, tapi tujuannya sama, menghambat ekspresi. Oke. Nah, ketiga orang tua ini diberikan GFP. Jadi warna hijau, ya. Dan ditambahkan RNAS. RNAS ini memiliki situs pengikatan yang berbeda, ya. Situs ikat yang berbeda. Jadi kalau RNAS-nya itu mengikat random, ya, dia mengikat gennya itu random, dia bakal tetap diproduksi, oke? Kalau dia random, GFP-nya bakal ada, ya, GFP-nya tetap ada. Namanya dia random ya, dia asal-asal mengikat di DNA yang asal-asal gitu, bagian DNA-nya. Jadi ya nggak ada efeknya gitu. Kalau dia mengikat di promoter, ya, kalau dia ngikat di promoter, dia bakal berkurang GFP-nya, ya. Kalau promoter, GFP-nya kurang. Kalau misalnya dia nempel di protein coding, ya, ini protein coding, dia bakal terhambat, ya, ini jadi hitam. Jadi dia bakal terhambat kalau di bagian protein coding, oke? GFP kena hambat. Nah, sekarang ini yang untreated ya, jadi ini nggak diapa-apain. Kita biarin aja. Kalau dia random, dia bisa diturunkan, ya. Ini kan sama-sama hijau, diturunkan. Kalau dia nempel di promoter, RNAS-nya, dia nggak bisa diturunkan. Ya, nggak bisa diturunkan. Kenapa nggak bisa diturunkan? Karena misalnya ini plasmid GFP ya. Ini plasmid GFP. Kalau RNAS-nya itu nempel di promoter, ya misalnya nempel di sini, ini promoter. Dia nggak bisa menduplikasi, ya. Dia nggak bisa menduplikasi, jadi dia nggak bisa menurunkan plasmid ini ke anaknya. Jadi anaknya tuh nggak punya GFP. Gitu ceritanya. Kalau dia nempel di promoter. Kalau dia nempel di protein coding, dia bisa di ini ya, bisa diteruskan. Ini kenapa hitam, sensei? Ini karena dia terhalang ekspresinya. Tapi bukan berarti gennya hilang. Enggak, gennya ada di sini, tapi ekspresinya terhambat. Gitu, terhambat ekspresinya, tapi gennya masih ada di sini. Makanya di sini gennya kelihatan, karena di sini nggak dihambat lagi sama sRNA, sama RNAS. Ya, dia hanya menghambat di sini. Di sini nggak. Gitu. Tapi gennya sama-sama ada, ya. I forgot to tell you that why this is black, okay? Why this is black? Because if the parents, okay, if the parents have plasmid, this is the GFP plasmid, okay? GFP plasmid. If the RNAS bind to the promoter, okay, this is the promoter maybe, and the RNAS will bind to the promoter, okay. If RNAS bind to the promoter, this plasmid cannot be replicated, okay, cannot be replicated. So if this plasmid cannot be replicated, it cannot inherit, it cannot inherit this plasmid to its offspring, okay? So that's why it cannot inherit the plasmid. Okay. Set, set, set. Okay, to the statements. So the first statement is leaf expressing GFP appear darker. This is false because this is the GFP, not this. Okay. RNA directed. Oh, I'm sorry, in Indonesia. Jadi katanya daun yang mengekspresikan GFP itu lebih gelap, salah ya. Udah jelas salah dong. Ini yang GFP itu ini, jadi lebih terang bukan lebih gelap. Now the second statement is RNA directed gene silencing is possible without using treatment RNA as designed to target mRNA. This is true. Why? Because we target a DNA here, okay? We target a DNA. Promoter is a part of DNA. Okay. Part of DNA or plasmid. So, it cannot inherit the GFP. It cannot inherit GFP to its offspring. And we only silence the DNA. Okay, we silence the DNA. So, if the gene silencing is possible without targeting the mRNA, this is true because we can also target the DNA. Okay, that's true. So this is true because we can also use DNA. Okay, the promoter is a part of DNA. This is true. Nah, jadi katanya ya di sini gen silencing itu bisa dibuat tanpa menarget mRNA. Bener ya? Karena di sini kita menarget DNA nih, ya. Ini kan promoter. Promoter itu bagian dari DNA atau plasmid. Jadi, kita bisa menarget DNA untuk silence, ya. Kita bisa menarget DNA. Nggak perlu mRNA, ya. Bisa DNA juga. Jadi, ini bener, ya. Bisa tanpa menarget mRNA. Kita target aja DNA, gitu ya. Now, the third statement is change in expression level of gene can be inherited from one generation to the next without mutating the DNA sequence. This is definitely true. Like I said before, it can be inherited like this, okay? It can be inherited like this for the positive result, and it can inherit the negative result also, okay? So, yeah, it can inherit both of the positive or negative. Okay? It can inherit without mutating the DNA sequence. That's true. We only inhibit them, okay? We only inhibit them. Not mutate. Okay, not mutated. Only inhibit. Okay, we inhibit them, not mutated. So, that's true without mutating. That's true. Nah, jadi katanya ya. Set, set. Nah, katanya perubahan ekspresi, perubahan level ekspresi dari gen ini bisa diturunkan tanpa memutasi DNA. Bener ya? Jadi di sini kita bisa lihat ya. Mau menurunkan gennya bisa. Mau menurunkan hambatannya bisa, ya. Jadi dua-duanya bisa diturunkan, maupun yang dihambat atau yang gennya langsung itu bisa diturunkan. Tanpa memutasi, benar ya, kita ini nggak pakai mutasi, kita hanya menghambat. Ya, kita hanya menghambat. Nggak ada mutasi di sini, ya. Jadi benar bisa, tanpa mutasi bisa. Ini kan bisa nih, cuma dihambat doang, gitu. Jadi ini benar, oke? Set. Set. Now, the last statement is silencing against the protein coding sequence is heritable. This is... Wait, I have to see the data first. Okay. silencing against the protein coding is heritable. Okay, silencing is heritable. Silencing is... heritable in protein coding Okay, this is the statement. So, this is inhibited. Inhibited. So, does the silencing does the silencing, okay, does the silencing is inherited to the offspring? No, okay, no. The silencing is not inherited because it's not inhibited, okay? This is GFP. So the inhibition only occurs in the mother, not in the child. Why? Because silencing is not inheritable. Because the silencing is not heritable, okay? The inhibition is not heritable in the protein coding, okay? So the inhibition is not heritable. But in the promoter, that's true because this is inhibited, okay? Inhibited. And the child is also inhibited. Okay? So, the inhibition is heritable. Okay? The silencing or inhibition, okay? This is the same as inhibition. Inhibition. Inhibition is heritable in protein coding. This is false. Okay? False. Because in the promoter, that's true. If the statement is in the promoter, okay? Inhibition is heritable in promoter, okay? So this is false. Okay, this is false, okay? Jadi katanya silencingnya itu bisa diturunkan di protein coding, okay ya? Silencingnya itu bisa diturunkan katanya. Nah, kalau di sini, ini tersilent kan? Ini tersilent. Apakah bisa diturunkan? Tidak. Karena ini tidak tersilent. Ya, ini tidak tersilent. Coba yang ini. Yang ini silent kan? Setengah silent sih. Setengah silent, tapi kan termasuk silent. Karena dia lebih redup. Anaknya gimana? Anaknya juga silent. Nah, jadi di sini silence-nya itu bisa diturunkan ya. Di sini bisa diturunkan. Di sini nggak bisa, ya. Jadi yang bisa diturunkan itu di bagian promoter. Kalau dia menempel di promoter, dia bisa diturunkan. Tapi kalau dia di bagian protein coding, silencing-nya itu nggak bisa diturunkan, ya. Jadi kalau katanya silencing-nya itu bisa diturunkan di bagian protein coding penempelannya, itu salah, ya. Harusnya di bagian promoter, ya. Kalau promoter baru benar. So, the answers are false, true, true, false. Jadi jawabannya adalah salah, benar-benar salah, okay? To the next question. The seventh question. Okay. This is the seventh question. So, we have CRISPR-Cas9, okay? If you want to learn more about CRISPR-Cas9, I have a link in description. In description. Okay, so you can click that link and watch the video so you can learn more about CRISPR-Cas9. So, Cas9 is protein from Streptococcus pyogenes. It's guided by 220 base pair guide RNA, okay? So, we need Cas9, that's the protein, and the guide RNA, okay, gRNA, as the guide, okay, oh, this is the picture, I didn't see that, so, the Cas9 can only make a double-strand cut in DNA 3 bases upstream from 5 to 3 prime site and GG, and this means nucleotide, okay? So it can be ATCG, it can be any one of this, okay? nucleotide. N stands for nucleotide. Double strand cuts are attacked by DNA degrading enzyme and then rejoin gene X, which you want to stop from function with this enzyme is shown in 2. Okay. Okay. And we also can use a pair of Cas9. Okay. We can use only one or a pair of Cas9. That's based on you. Now, this is the guide RNA. We can see the guide RNA is located behind the NGG site. Okay, this is the NGG site. This is the NGG site, and behind the NGG site, we have the guide RNA. Okay, we have the guide RNA behind the NGG site, and we can see that gRNA, okay, this is the gRNA, this is RNA, so we have to change the T, okay, the T to U, okay, T mean to uracil, because this is RNA, okay, so this is the same, okay, you can see this is the same, C. Wait. Oh, this is the same. I'm sorry. This and this is the same. Okay, you can see C C G G G G G G A C G C G A G A G A. Okay, this is the same. The only difference is it may contain T. Okay, but the gRNA will contain U. Okay, T becomes U. But because here we have no T, okay, we have no T, so we have no U here. Okay, I hope you can understand me. I'm so sorry, my English so broken. Nah. Oh, before that, this is our target DNA. Okay. I'll explain in Indonesia first before going to the statement. Oke, jadi di sini ya kita bakal belajar tentang CRISPR-Cas9. Jadi kalau kalian mau tahu lebih lanjut itu ada link di deskripsi. Jadi kalian bisa tonton videonya dan itu bakal menjelaskan apa sih CRISPR-Cas9 itu. Nah, jadi CRISPR-Cas9 itu adalah teknologi yang menggunakan protein Cas9 dari Streptococcus yang memakai gRNA. Oke, ini ya gRNA. Di mana Cas9 itu bisa memotong di bagian atas dari NGG. Oke, NGG ini maksudnya N ini nukleotida. Jadi bisa diganti A, T, G, atau C. Oke ya, misalnya AGG atau TGG gitu ya. Nah, setelah itu dia bakal memotong DNA dan menyambungnya kembali. Ada dua cara. Kalian bisa memakai satu Cas9 maupun dua Cas9 ini ya. Bisa memakai dua Cas9 juga. Jadi tergantung kebutuhan deh gitu. Oke ya, di situ. Nah, sekarang kalian bisa lihat di sini. Ini NGG-nya ya. Ini NGG. CGG di sini ya. Jadi NGG site-nya itu di sini, sementara gRNA-nya itu di sini. Ini gRNA ya. gRNA. Nah, gRNA itu sama sequence-nya dengan yang ini. Ya, ini sama ini. Nah, kalian bisa lihat di sini ada C ya, ketutupan lagi. C, G, 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 A, 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 C, G, C, G, A, G, A, A, G, A. Sama kan? Nah, bedanya apa? Bedanya di sini mungkin nanti ada T. Sementara di sini harus U. Ya, ingat ya. T harus kita ganti jadi U. Karena T ini DNA, U itu RNA. Ya, ini RNA loh. Jadi kalau di sini ada T, kita harus ganti ke U. Tapi di sini kan nggak ada T, jadi di sini juga nggak ada U, gitu ya. Nah, itu menjebak sebenarnya. Nah, sekarang inilah target kita. Inilah target kita. Oke, nih. Now, we can. Oh, before the statement, we have to answer this. Oke, you have 5 gRNA. Sequence to choose from 1 to 5. Okay, we have to choose one of these. Okay, one of these. Which one? So, we can see here. gRNA is the same with the target DNA, okay? The same with target DNA. The only difference is G becomes U. Okay. Now, we can see here the NGG site is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 NGG site. Okay. So, behind this, we can see behind that, okay? You can see behind that. This is the gRNA, okay? They are the same. So, you can see here ACCGGAT. ACC, okay. ACCGGAT. GGAT etc. Okay? Etc. So, which one? ACC, okay, ACC, ACCGGAT, this is true. ACCGGAU, this is true, okay. From this is true. UGGC, UGGC. There is UGGC. UGGC, okay. We have to find UGGC, maybe. UGGC, okay, ACC. T, C, T, G, G, T, T, A, G, C. There is no U, G, G, C. Okay, there is no. So, if you want to check them personally, you can do that. But I will not. So, I already know we have no this, okay? We have no sequence like this. So the only possible choices is here, are here and here. Which one is true? The true sequence is the number 2. Okay, the number 2. Why the number 2? Because we have to change the T. Okay, we have to change the T. This is T. We have to change that into U because we find the gRNA, okay, RNA, so G becomes U, okay, G, this is G, this is wrong, G, 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 okay, we cannot use G, we have to change the G to U, okay, this is U, 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 this is true, okay, so the answer is the second gRNA, okay. Now in Indonesia. Nah, jadi kita harus memilih gRNA mana yang benar nih. Nah, jadi ya, kita bisa lihat di sini. Kan gRNA itu terlihat setelah NGG-nya. Ini ada 1 2 3 4 5 NGG site. Oke. Pertama kita lihat yang ini. Nah, ini kan pas di belakangnya ini kan sama aja nih. Yang ini dengan yang ini kan sama aja. Nah, sama aja. Jadi kita lihat aja belakangnya langsung. A C C G G A T. Oke ya. A, C, C, G, G, A, T. Ini yang di belakang NGG site yang pertama. Oke ya, kita lihat di sini ada nggak yang kayak gitu. A, C, C, G, G, A, T. A, C, C, G, G, A, T. Nah, ini ada nih, Sensei. Oke, ini ada. A, C, C, G, G, A, U. Ini juga ada ya, Sensei, sampai sini ya. Nih ya, ini sama ya. Kalau kalian mau mastiin satu-satu juga boleh, tapi Sensei udah nyari ya. Jadi ini nggak ada ya, tiga ini nggak ada satupun. Misalnya ini ya, UCUA, oke ya, UCUA, UCUA, ada nggak di sini UCUA? Kita lihat ya. Di belakang ini ACCG, di belakang ini TTTT, belakang ini CTG, belakang ini GTT, belakang ini ACG, AGC. Jadi nggak ada yang UCU, ya, nggak ada. Jadi sebenarnya tiga-tiga ini nggak ada. Pilihannya mana yang benar, Sensei? Yang benar adalah yang nomor 2. 2 benar. Kenapa 2 benar? Karena yang satu ini masih T. Ya, ingat ya, T-nya harus kita ganti jadi U. Karena ini tanya itu RNA. Ya, jadi T-nya harus jadi U. Inilah dia yang benar. U, 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 U. Jadi jawabannya adalah nomor 2, ya. Jadi kalian silang di bagian kotak nomor 2. Oke. Okay. Now, the second question. NGG site, okay. This is mean the first. NGG site. Encoding. Region. Okay. This question means the first NGG site encoding region. Okay. you can see here the first NGG site in coding region. Coding regions start from first amino acid to the stop codon. Okay, so the first NGG site is this. Okay, from here, here. Okay, this is the first NGG site. The second NGG site. Okay, the second NGG site. So this is the answer. Why? Because in the protein, we only see the coding region. Okay, we only see the coding region in the protein. So, if we want to see the NGG site in the product, we have to see the NGG site in the coding region. Okay, I hope you can understand me. So this is mean the first NGG site in the coding sequence. Okay, and if we want to disrupt the protein, if we want to disrupt the protein, the second NGG site is the best. Okay, not the first. This is we have to find the gRNA for the first NGG site, but the first NGG site is not the best. Okay, this is not the best. This is not the best. This is the best. Why this is the best NGG site? Because if it being cut, okay, if it being cut, if we cut here, okay, maybe if we cut here, so if we cut here, frame shift mutation will occur. Okay, frame shift will occur. How? Like this. This is the normal DNA. Okay, this is the NGG site. Okay, the second NGG site. So if we cut here and we use the second NGG site, it will become like this. This is unknown DNA. Okay, nah, like this, it become like this. Okay, if it become like this, it's like we insert, okay, we insert some nucleotide. Okay, we insert some nucleotides, so the frame shift will occur. So from here to the downstream will be wrong. Okay, so if we want to disrupt the protein, the second NGG site is the best. Okay, because it will disrupt all of this. All of this will be disrupted. Okay, so the second is the best, not the first NGG site. Okay, set. So if we want to choose the best NGG site and the first NGG site in the coding region, it will be the second NGG site. Okay, now in Indonesia, nah, jadi kita mau memilih site NGG mana sih yang paling bagus untuk dimutasiin gitu, yang untuk dipotong maksud sensei. NGG site mana sih yang paling bagus untuk dilakukan pemotongan? Nah, yang paling bagus itu adalah yang di coding region, ya, di bagian coding. Jadi bagian sini ya, dari first amino acid sampai stop codon. Yang bagus itu bagian sini. Bagusnya yang mana sensei? Yang 2, yang 3, yang 4, atau yang 5? Bagusan yang 2. Ya, yang 1 nggak masuk ya. Karena kan ini bacanya ke sini. Nah, jadi yang 2 yang paling bagus. Kenapa? Karena kalau misalnya begini ya, ini gen normal. Nah, ini gen normal. Misalnya ini dia bagian NGG kedua. Ya, NGG kedua. Nah, kalau misalnya kita potong di bagian sini, kan dia di belakang dipotong. Kalau dipotong, dia bakal jadi begini. Nah, ini bakal jadi DNA asing. Ini sekuen asing, asal-asalan ya. Nah, ini site keduanya. Dia dipotong baru disambung, kan kayak ini dia. Tapi disambung di sini ada yang menginterupsi gitu. Jadi ini salah nukleotidanya. Jadi ini mirip insersi kan? Insersi nukleotida. Dan ini menciptakan frame shift. Frame shift. Kalau ada frame shift, berarti dari sini ke sini salah semua. Oke, ini salah semua. Jadi kalau kita potong di sini ya, bagian sini sampai ujung itu bakal salah semua. Dan itulah fungsi utama dari CRISPR ini, untuk mematikan gennya. Jadi yang paling bagus tuh pakai yang kedua gitu ya, biar mati semua ini ininya apa proteinnya biar jelek banget gitu. Gitu ya. Jadi kodonnya itu kacau gitu. Jadi yang paling bagus untuk dipilih itu adalah NGG site yang kedua, gitu ya. Bukan yang pertama, kan yang pertama itu di luar coding region, gitu ya. Nah, now the first statement. Using the pair of modified Cas9, increase of target damage to other gene. This is of course false. If we use two, okay, we use two Cas9. This is ya, yeah, the pair. Two Cas9, it will increase the the accuracy. Okay, the accuracy. Increase the accuracy. If the accuracy increase, the damage to other gene will decrease. Okay? Decrease. Accuracy is increased, so the damage to other gene of course will decrease. Okay? This is false, not increase. Okay? Decrease is the right answer. Nah, jadi katanya di sini ya, menggunakan sepasang Cas9 itu bakal meningkatkan kerusakan gen lainnya. Itu salah ya. Karena kalau kita pakai 2 Cas9 ya, 2 Cas9 itu bakal semakin spesifik. Makin spesifik. Jadi dia nggak bakal nyasar ke gen lain gitu. Jadi kerusakan ke gen lain itu bakal berkurang ya. Harusnya berkurang. Ini malah dia bilang bertambah. Jadi salah ya. Gitu. Now, the second statement is the Streptococcus pyogenes genome has more NGG site than expected by genes. This is of course false. Why? Because the Streptococcus is the main producer, okay? Is the main producer of Cas9. What's the main function of Cas9? It will break down DNA of viruses. Okay? This is the main reason why Streptococcus produce Cas9. Because it want to break down the DNA of viruses that attack the Streptococcus. So, the Streptococcus will have fewer, okay? Fewer NGG site. Why? Because the Cas9 will attack NGG site. Attack NGG site. If the Streptococcus have more NGG site, it will attack its own DNA. Okay? It will attack its own DNA. That's bad. So, it cannot have more NGG. Okay? This is wrong. Less. Right. Okay? Nah, jadi katanya Streptococcus ini memiliki lebih banyak NGG situs daripada yang diekspektasikan. Tentu aja salah. Kenapa? Karena Streptococcus ini murninya ya, alaminya dia memproduksi Cas9 itu untuk melawan virus, untuk hancurkan DNA virus. Ya. Jadi dia itu bakal punya NGG yang lebih sedikit. NGG sedikit. Karena kalau NGG-nya banyak di gennya dia, bisa-bisa proteinnya nyerang diri dia sendiri. Gitu. Jadi bahaya ya. Jadi nggak boleh banyak-banyak NGG-nya. Jadi di gennya dia, itu NGG-nya sedikit. Biar Cas9-nya itu nggak nyerang diri dia sendiri. Gitu ya. Nah, jadi ini salah kalau dia bilang banyak ya. Salah, harusnya sedikit. Now, the last statement. If the gene has no GG sequence, Cas9 from other species should be investigated for alternative. That's true. Because the Streptococcus only produce the NGG Cas9. So we have to have the GG sequence in our genome. We have to have the GG sequence in our genome. So if the gene has no GG, we cannot use this. If the gene has no GG, we cannot use this. Instead, we have to use Cas9 from other species. So, this is true. Okay? Nah, jadi katanya, kalau gennya itu nggak ada sequence GG, maka kita harus mencari spesies lain. Cas9 dari spesies lain. Itu benar. Karena kan, yang Cas9 dari Streptococcus ini mengincar NGG. Ya, NGG. Kalau nggak ada GG-nya, ya, kalau gen kita itu nggak ada GG-nya, kita nggak bisa pakai ini, nggak bisa pakai Cas9 dari Streptococcus. Kita harus nyari Cas9 dari spesies lain. Jadi itu benar ya. So, the answers are false, false, true. Jadi jawabannya adalah salah, salah, benar. Oke. Okay? Now, to the next question. Okay, this is about replication fork. So you can pause the video and read this. Okay, I'll explain the picture. Now, the first is beta clam. Yes, tube-shaped clam. Okay, this is clam. Two is topo isomeris. 3 is ssDNA. ssDNA. Protein, I mean. And the fourth is different polymerases. Okay, so this is fourth. This is fourth. This is four. Okay. Now, what is this? What are this? What are this? I hope that's true. I hope I'm right. Okay, what are this? This is DNA polymerase 3. Okay, this is DNA polymerase 3. Because the polymerase that bind to clam, okay, this is the clam complex or the DNA pol complex. The polymerase that bind to polymerase complex is polymerase 3. Okay, the one that's not bind to the polymerase complex, okay, this is the polymerase complex. If the polymerase not bind to the polymerase complex, this is the DNA polymerase 1. Okay, where is the DNA polymerase 2? Maybe this is polymerase 2, but I'm not really sure about that because polymerase 2 is just accessory polymerase. Okay, this is just accessory. I'm sorry. this is just accessory and not really important actually. So, have no major roles. So this about the picture, okay? Nah, jadi di sini kalian bisa pause dan baca, tapi sensei bakal jelasin gambarnya aja. Nah, yang pertama ini adalah tube-shaped clam, okay? Ini tube-shaped clam. Jadi dia itu untuk menarik DNA, ya, menarik DNA. Satu untai DNA ditarik sama dia. Kalau yang kedua itu topo, ya, ini topo. Yang ketiga itu SS protein. Protein. Yang keempat itu adalah polimerase yang berbeda-beda. Jadi ini ada 1, 2, 3, 4. Oke. Yang ini adalah DNA polimerase 3. Kenapa? Karena DNA polimerase 3 bakal menempel dengan polimerase kompleks ya. Ini polimerase kompleks. Kalau dia menempel, berarti dia DNA pol 3. Oke ya. Ini kan nggak menempel nih. Berarti ini adalah DNA pol 1. DNA pol 2 mana sensei? Mungkin ini mungkin DNA pol 2. Ini BTW ini juga ya. Ini juga DNA pol 3. Ini DNA pol 2 mungkin, tapi sensei kurang yakin karena DNA pol 2 itu jarang terlihat. Dia hanya aksesori ya, aksesori polimerase. Jadi sensei kurang yakin ini polimerase 2 atau enggak gitu. Oke. Okay? Jadi ini yang bisa sensei jelasin dari gambar. Now, to the statements. Oke. Okay. Antibiotics which poison topo isomerase cause DNA ahead of the fork become over twist. Okay, so if you want to know how topo isomerase works, you can click the link in this video description. You can watch the video and that video will explain to you how topoisomerase work, okay? Topoisomerase will prevent overcoiling. Okay, prevent overcoiling. What's the meaning of overcoiling? Like this. This is the normal coiling. DNA nomor coil. Overcoiling is like this. Okay, this is overcoiling. Okay, and topoisomerase prevent the overcoiling. So if the antibiotics poison topoisomerase, it will become over twist. This is true. Okay, now, oh, in Indonesia. Jadi ya, nih katanya kalau ada antibiotik yang meracuni topoisomerase, DNA-nya bakal over twisted atau tergulung parah gitu ya. Kayak benang layang-layang ya, dia tergulung parah gitu. Nah, jadi kalau kalian mau tahu gimana cara kerja topoisomerase ya, itu ada link-nya di deskripsi video, kalian bisa tonton. Itu jelas di situ diperlihatkan gimana sih cara kerja topoisomerase. Nah, normalnya ya dalam kata-kata, topoisomerase itu bakal mencegah overcoiling. Apa itu overcoiling, Sensei? Misalnya begini ya. Ini coil yang normal. DNA coil normal. Kalau overcoiling, dia bakal jadi gini. Nah, ini overcoiling. Ya, jadi dia kayak menggulung-gulung gak jelas gitu. Nah, jadi topoisomerase itu mencegah ini. Tapi kalau topoisomerase-nya diracuni, tentu dia bakal overtwisted. Atau overcoiling, ini sama ya. Nah, jadi ini benar. Oke? Okay? Now, the second statement is an activity of polymerase complex X is to replace ribonucleotide uracil with thymidine. Okay, X. This is the X. This is polymerase 1. What's the function of polymerase 1? Replace Okazaki fragment, okay, with DNA. This is the function of polymerase 1. So, Okazaki fragment is RNA. So, if we want to replace RNA with DNA, so we will replace U2T, okay, uracil to thymidine. So this is true. Okay, that's true. Set. Nah, jadi katanya yang X itu fungsinya untuk mengubah urasil jadi timin, ya. Nih. Katanya yang ini fungsinya merubah urasil jadi timin. Ini apa? Ini polimerase 1, ya. Polimerase 1. Fungsinya apa? Fungsinya adalah menukar Okazaki. Jelek banget tulisan sensei, maaf ya. Menukar Okazaki fragment jadi DNA. Okazaki fragment itu adalah RNA. Kok Okazaki fragment salah? Primer. Sorry, sensei salah. I'm wrong. Not Okazaki fragment. Primer. I'm so sorry. Primer, okay? So, it changes primer to DNA. Okay? To DNA. Primer is RNA. Okay? So, we have to replace U with thymidine. Okay? Uracil with thymidine. I'm sorry, that's not Okazaki fragment, that's primer. I'm so sorry. Nah, jadi itu primer ya, bukan Okazaki fragment. Sensei silap. Nah, jadi itu benar ya. RNA jadi DNA, tentu saja uracil kita ubah jadi timin. Jadi itu benar. Okay? Now, the third statement, enzyme I is preferentially loaded at CG-rich sequence. Okay, CG-rich sequence. What be C? Okay, this is the nucleotide. A to T is 2 hydrogen bond. G to C is 3 hydrogen bond. If I'm not wrong, hydrogen bond. But The point is A to T is 2 bond, G to C is 3 bond. So if GC reads sequence, it means sturdy sequence. Okay, sturdy or hard sequence. Hard to separate them. Okay, hard to separate. So enzyme I. Okay, enzyme I. This is the enzyme I. Okay, this is I. Tube-shaped clamp which pulls on one DNA strand. Okay, pulls on one DNA strand. So it will separate. Okay, separate the DNA. So if we want to separate sturdy sequence, which one will you choose? Separate a sturdy sequence or separate an easy sequence? Which one will you choose? Of course we will choose the easy sequence. Okay, we will prefer this because the sturdy sequence is hard to separate. Okay, hard to separate. So enzyme I prefer CG reads. That's false. Okay, it will prefer the easy sequence, not the CG reads sequence, because CG reads sequence is sturdy. Okay, hard to separate. Okay, that's the point. Nah, jadi katanya di sini enzim yang I itu ya, yang I Romawi itu lebih suka yang GC, apa namanya, sequence yang kayak GC ya, yang banyak GC-nya. Nah, sekarang ada, nah begini ya, A ke T itu ada 2 ikatan, sementara G ke C itu 3 ikatan. Jadi kalau dia banyak G dan C-nya, berarti ini keras ya, ini keras karena ikatannya 3, keras banget. Nah, sekarang apa fungsi dari yang I? Fungsinya adalah pulls on one DNA strand. Jadi dia itu menarik satu DNA, alias dia memisahkan. Memisah DNA. Nah, kalau kita jadi dia, kita lebih suka mana? Memisah yang keras banget atau memisah yang gampang? Tentu kita bakal milih yang gampang, ya kan? Nah, jadi kita nggak bakal milih yang keras banget ya. Ini susah soalnya, misahinnya ini susah. Nah, jadi ini salah ya, false. Jadi dia katanya lebih suka yang keras. Enggak, dia lebih suka yang gampang ya. Karena yang keras ini susah dipisah ya, mereka terlalu banyak ikatannya gitu. Oke. Okay. Now the last statement. Protein III assist complementary base pairing. III single-stranded DNA binding protein. So, what's the function of ssDNA binding protein? The function is to stabilize single DNA strand. Like this. This is single strand. This is double strand. The single-stranded DNA protein will bind to the single strand. You can see here, it bind to single strand to stabilize them. Okay, to stabilize them. So it has no function in base pairing. Okay, it has no function in base pairing. So this is false. It will not assist base pairing. It's only stabilize them. Okay, stabilize the DNA. Nah, jadi katanya protein yang 3 Romawi itu membantu base pairing. Kayak mana ya base pairing? Penambahan pasangan basa gitu. Penambahan pasangan basa. Apakah dia membantu? Nah, kalian bisa lihat di sini adalah single stranded DNA binding protein. Jadi fungsinya apa? Fungsinya adalah stabilisasi. Menstabilkan yang satu strand gini ya, dia menstabilkan, makanya dia nempelnya di sini. Dia fungsinya hanya menstabilkan, bukan membantu memasang-masangkan ya. Jadi salah kalau dia bilang membantu memasang-masangkan. Ya katanya membantu base pairing, membantu masang-masangkan. Enggak ya. Dia hanya menstabilisasi gitu ya. So the answers are true, true, false, false. Jadi jawabannya adalah benar-benar, salah-salah. To the next question. Okay. This is the... Wait. Okay, so this is the ninth question. Now, you can pause this video and read this intro, but I will not read that because this not really informative. So, we have to look at this picture. This is RNA and DNA. So, you can see here, this small strand is RNA and the bigger strand is DNA. Same with this and this. Okay? Now, this is the from the electron microscope. This is the more graphical picture, okay? More clearer picture. So, first I have to explain it in Indonesia. Jadi, di sini ya, kalian bisa baca, pause dulu atau dan baca ini, tapi sensei bakal jelasin langsung ke gambarnya. Di sini kalian bisa lihat ya, di sini ada RNA dan DNA. Dan bisa lihat di sini yang tipis ini adalah RNA, yang tebal adalah DNA, gitu ya. Nah, ini bagian dari mikroskop, gambar dari mikroskop yang asli, ini yang lebih dibersihin lah gambarnya, gitu ya. Now, to the statements. Each adenovirus RNA is transcribed from the same DNA strand for the whole RNA. Okay. This picture is too small. I'm so sorry, this picture is too small. You can download the question sheet in description, okay? I have the link in description. You can download this and you can observe more carefully on this, okay? So, if you can see here, we have one RNA, the small RNA, comes from this strand, okay? This strand, the upper strand, and twist to the lower strand. Yes, if I'm not mistaken this. So, I already observe all of this more carefully. So, this is true. This is true. Because you can see here, this comes from one single strand. Okay? If I maximize that, it will be like this maybe. Okay? And then here become like this. Okay, this is the double stranded. Now the RNA comes from here and here, so this is the same strand. Okay, from this strand. Okay, this is the template. This is the RNA. This is the template DNA. Okay, this is the template DNA. This. And oh, I'm sorry, I'm wrong. Set. I'm wrong. The picture is not like that, like this. Okay, yes, normally like this. Now the RNA is here. Okay, here. Now, this is just my picture, my personal picture. So, this RNA comes from this strand, okay? This strand, these strands, and this strand. So, this is the same strand, okay? The upper strand. So, yes, that comes from the upper strand. But in this case, we have two RNA here and here. Okay, so the case is like this. Okay, and then we have wait. Okay, like this. Okay, this is the picture. Okay, now the first RNA is here, and the second RNA is here. But they are different RNA, means they are different, they have different proteins, and they have their own identity, okay? So here, it's RNA, okay? It's RNA. So we have two RNA, one, two, in this picture, okay? Its RNA comes from the same DNA strand, okay? This comes from the upper strand, right? From the upper strand, and this comes from the lower strand, okay? Comes from the lower strand. So they are individually different, okay? So its RNA, this and this is different RNA, not the same. So they are individually different. So this is true, okay? It still comes from the same strand for the whole RNA. The same strand, the whole RNA. The same strand, the whole RNA. Okay? That's true. That's not like this. If it becomes like this, from here and then here, this is comes from a different strand, okay? This is from the upper strand and this is from the lower strand, okay? This is the case if the statement is wrong, okay? This is the case if the statement is wrong, okay? Jadi sekarang katanya setiap RNA datang dari strand DNA yang sama. Oke, jadi ini kalau kalian kurang nampak ya, ada linknya di deskripsi, link download soalnya. Download aja, bisa kalian zoom dan kalian perhatikan baik-baik ya. Jadi kalau misalnya sensei gambar di sini, misalnya yang ini deh, sensei perbesar ya. Gini. Nah, kira-kira gambarnya itu seperti ini. Nah, begini kira-kira ya. Nah, jadi di sini ada dua RNA. Ini satu. Ini dua. Kalau kalian perhatikan nanti kalian dulu soalnya ya. Jadi di sini ada satu RNA, di sini satu lagi. Katanya setiap RNA, ya. Jadi ini beda dengan ini, ya. RNA-nya beda. Yang ini datang dari template yang bagian atas, ya. Template-nya bagian atas. Sementara yang ini template-nya yang bagian bawah, ya. DNA bagian bawah template-nya. Nah, jadi setiap RNA memang punya template dari strand yang sama. Jadi yang satu RNA ini datang dari satu strand. Strand bawah dia. Yang RNA ini datang dari satu strand juga, strand atas doang. Nah, statement ini bisa salah kalau ada kasus kayak gini. Misalnya ini DNA-nya ya. Di sini ada RNA. Nah, kalau gini ini baru salah pernyataannya kalau ada yang gambarnya kayak gini. Misalnya ini kan dari atas nih, template-nya yang atas, yang ini template-nya yang bawah gitu. Jadi ini kan dua template gitu. Ya, jadi nggak from the same strand. Ini nggak the same strand ya, ini beda strand-nya. Jadi ini bakal salah kalau ada yang kayak gini. Tapi di semua gambar ini nggak ada yang kayak gini, ya. Jadi ini benar. Oke? Okay? Benar yang A. Yang A, statement pertama. The second statement, oh, I'm sorry, the number. Adenovirus mRNA remains bound in a DNA-RNA hybrid for a period of time. That's true. You can see there are hybridization even here. Oke? Okay? Nah, katanya mRNA-nya itu bakal dalam bentuk hubungan DNA-RNA hybrid untuk beberapa waktu. Itu benar ya, karena kalian bisa lihat di sini mereka berhybrid. Jadi RNA-nya itu nempel sama DNA-nya untuk beberapa saat. Jadi itu benar ya, mereka bakal jadi hybrid. The third statement is transcription requires helicase activity. This is true. Because transcription, we need to separate them, okay? If the strand is still compactly like this, it cannot be transcribed. Okay? We have to separate them. We have to open up and separate them with helicase. Okay? This is the function of helicase. So we can perform transcription here to produce RNA like this. Okay? That's true. Jadi katanya di sini transkripsi itu memerlukan helikase. Benar ya, karena kalau misalnya DNA-nya itu masih kompak begini, masih compact, dia nggak bisa ditembus ya, nggak bisa ditranskripsi. Tapi kalau misalnya kita pakai helikase, helikase kan fungsinya membuka ini ya, membuka strand ya. Jadi dia bakal terbuka gini. Dan kalau udah terbuka ya, seperti ini kan terbuka, ini terbuka, ini terbuka, ini ter... Oh ya udah, ini ya. Dia baru bisa ditranskripsi menjadi RNA, gitu ya. Jadi itu benar, kita perlu helikase. Oke. The last statement is... I have to move. Okay, the last statement is mRNA splicing of this adenovirus is similar to eukaryotic splicing. This is false because in eukaryotic splicing, we will transcribe, okay? Transcribe every the whole RNA, I mean, the whole DNA. If this is the eukaryotic DNA, we have to first separate them with helicase, and then we have to transcribe all of this. Okay, we have to transcribe all of this, and after that, the RNA will be spliced. Okay, the RNA will be spliced like this, maybe. Like this. This is the eukaryotic splicing. But in this adenovirus, we see that this is the DNA. Adenovirus. This is the DNA. And it can transcribe here and here. Like this. Here and here. Like, it can separately transcribe them. Okay? The transcription... The transcription is segmented. Okay, they are segmented like this and here and maybe there and maybe wherever. But in eukaryotic DNA, we cannot do this. We have to transcribe the whole gene. Okay, that's we are different. Okay. Nah, jadi katanya yang splicing di adenovirus ini sama dengan eukariot. Itu salah ya. Karena kalian bisa lihat di eukariot itu kita harus mentranskripsi ya, ini eukariot. Kita harus mentranskripsi semua gen. Setelah itu RNA-nya yang udah jadi kita potong, ya kan? Nah, ini di eukariot. Tapi kalau di ini adenovirus ini di adeno ini kita bisa lihat di sini dia itu tersegmentasi ya, bisa di sini transkripsinya, di sini nih ya, kalian bisa lihat dia tersegmentasi, jadi beda sama kita. Kita itu semua dulu ditranskripsi baru dipotong. Kalau dia enggak, dia dari awal memang udah tersegmentasi, jadi enggak perlu dipotong-potong lagi sebenarnya ya. Mungkin ada modifikasinya, mungkin ada, tapi dia segmented begini ya. Nah, jadi kita beda ya, enggak sama, jadi salah. So the answers are true, 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 false. Jadi jawabannya adalah benar-benar salah. Okay, to the next question. Now, okay, here we have a dystrophin gene. Okay, dystrophin gene is a very large gene. Okay, RNA polymerase move along DNA 30. Okay, 30 base pair per second. Per second. DNA polymerase has an error rate of 1 minus 8. Okay. 10 minus 8. 10 minus minus 8. Error rate. Oh, I'm sorry. Error. Repair system letter correct 99% of the mistake. Okay. 99% fix. And then... okay, that's all we have. Okay, now we can see here the whole gene is 2.5 mega base pair. Mega means 2.5. Mega means 60. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 60. So here and here. Okay, this is the base pair. Okay, mega base pair. And the mRNA is kilo base pair. Kilo means 3, 0, 1, 2, 3 base pair. This is the gene this is the mRNA. Okay, here you can see. Now, before we talk about this, we have to answer this first, okay? Wait, I'll have to explain it in Indonesia. Jadi, di sini kita bisa baca ya. Dia itu ada gen dystropin. Dan RNA polymerase dystropin itu bakal bergerak di DNA-nya itu sebanyak 30 base pair per detik ya, 30 base pair per detik. Dan ada error rate-nya sebesar 10 pangkat minus 8 ya errornya. Tapi errornya itu bakal diperbaiki 99%. Nah, di sini kita bisa lihat DNA-nya itu 2,5 mega base pair. Mega itu berarti 10 pangkat 6 ya. Jadi dikali 6 nolnya. Ini ada 1 2 3 4 5 6. Jadi 2 juta 2 oh. Here. Nah, gini ya. 25 juta base pair. 25 juta base pair. Dan di mRNA-nya itu ada 14 KB. KB itu kilo ya. Kilo itu berarti 10 pangkat 3. Jadi nolnya ada 3, 14.000 base pair. Gitu ya. Sebelum ke yang ini, kita bakal jawab ini dulu, okay? So, the first answer is select the nearest time to the correct answer. So, we have to count the finish time, okay? The finish time. For RNA polymerase. The whole gene is 25 million, yes, million base pair. And the RNA polymerase only transcribe 30 base pair per second. 30 base pair per second. Okay, so take your calculator and I will use my calculator too. Okay, we can use that. Okay, that's legal. That's legal in this competition of biology. Okay, wait, I'll have to count this. So the answer is 833,333.33. So this is seconds. I hope I pronounced that right. I'm so sorry about my broken English. So, seconds, okay? It equals 2. We have to divide it, divide by 60. 13,888.88 minutes. And then we have to divide it again by 60 equals to I'm sorry, I have a mistake here. So here, this is the mistake. Set 2.5 mega base pair. 2.5. I'm sorry, 0.5. So we have to add only 50, okay? Because this point only 50. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is here and this is here, okay? I was wrong. I'm sorry. So here we have to decrease the 0. Okay, this is same like 2.5 times this. Okay, I'm sorry, not negative. Okay, like this, okay? This is the same. Now, this is like this. Okay, now this is like this. Okay. Okay. Like this. I'm wrong. So let it. Okay. Here. Okay, and this is 1,000 actually. 1,388.88 minutes. Okay, here we have. Now we have to divide this by 60. 1,388.88. And the answer is 2:23. Okay, this is the answer. Okay, 23 hours. Okay, that's the answer. So 23 hours means 1 day. Okay, this is the question. This is the answer. 1 day. Okay. Nah, jadi di sini tadi sensei ada salah sedikit ya. Jadi 2,5 kali 10 pakan 6 itu adalah 2.500.000 maksud sensei. Jadi 2.500.000 ya dibagi, dia cuma 30 BP per second. 30 BP per second. Nah, itu hasilnya tadi adalah 83.333,33333 gitu ya. Ini adalah menit. Detik. Ya, ini kan masih detik nih. Detik. Nah, sekarang ubah ke menit, berarti bagi 60 ya. Bagi 60 itu adalah 1388,88 menit. Bagi lagi 60 berarti hasilnya adalah 23 jam. Nah, 23 jam itu kan sama dengan 1 hari, mendekati ya. Karena kan nearest, jadi mendekati doang. Jadi ya, jawabannya adalah 1 hari. Oke? Okay? Now, the second question. Choose the nearest number to the correct answer. This is the error rate, okay? For one error, we have to for one error, how many base pair, okay? One error, how many base pair? How many base pair for one error like that? So we have this this base pair of gene, okay? Base pair, and 10 and minus 8 error. Okay, we have to multiply that by this. And 99% will be fixed. So only 1%, okay? Only 1% is error. This is the error. Okay, this is the error. This times 1%. Okay, 1%. So the answer is, okay, the answer is 0.00025. Okay, this is the mistakes. Okay, this is not one error, this is 0.00025 error. We have to find one error. Okay, so if we want to find one error, we have to divide this. One divide this. Okay, one divide this. Now calculate that. That will be 4,000. Okay, 1/0. I have to erase this. Okay, 1/0.00025 is 4,000. Okay, base pair. So this is the one error. Okay, for one error, for one error to occur, it has to transcribe 4,000 base pair. Okay, this is the answer. 4,000 base pair. 4,000. 5,000, okay? Nearest 4,000, near 5,000. This is the answer, okay? now in Indonesia. Nah, jadi katanya ini adalah angka berapa base pair untuk satu error, ya, berapa base pair untuk satu kali error. Nah, di sini dia punya 2.500.000 ya. 2.500.000 base pair dikali kesalahannya itu hanya 10 pangkat minus 8. Dikali lagi 99% itu dibagusi. Berarti yang salah itu hanya 1%. Ya. Nah, kalau kalian kalikan ini maka hasilnya adalah 0,00025. Nah, ini masih 0,00025. Kita kan mau nyari satu error, ya. Ini masih 0,00025 error nih. Nah, jadi cara nyarinya adalah kita bagi ya, jadi 1 per 0,00025. Kita kan mau nyari satu error. Berarti berapa jawabannya? Ini adalah 4.000. Jadi 4.000 base pair untuk satu error. Ya, jadi dia harus mentranskripsi 4.000 base pair baru kemungkinan ada satu error, gitu ya. Nah, jadi 4.000 base pair. 4.000 base pair dekat dengan 5.000. Jadi ini jawabannya ya. These are the answer. Now, we have to discuss about this picture. Okay. Now, we have the child that have the muscular dystrophy. So, muscular dystrophy will will make the cut site disappear. Okay, will make the cut site disappear. So there is no cut site. So if we use 1a plus 2, it will have 1000 long, okay, 1000 base pair long, if I'm not wrong. Yes, base pair long. So from 1a to the end, it will be 1000 base pair. Okay, and if we use 1b, this is the 1b, it only 900 base pair. Okay, it indicates the primer 1a only 100 base pair long. Okay, 1a 100 base pair. And then we can see that the father is healthy. 1a plus 2, it means it have the cut size. Okay, cut site. He has the cut site. So, if 1a, we use 1a, it will be 700 and 300, I'm sorry. So, here and here. It will be cut, okay? So, which one is 100, which one is 300? We have to see the 1B, okay? 1B is 200, this is 200, and 700, 700 and 200, okay? 700, 700, this is the same, 700, 700. So, it must be here, okay? It must be here. This is 700 and 700. And the 200 must be here, because it is shorter. 1B is shorter than 1A. Okay? It must be 200 and this is 300. Okay? You can see here. So, we can answer the question. Primer 1B binding site. Okay, 1B. 1B bind here. So, this is the first base pair and this is the 1000 base pair. 100, okay? It will bind to the 100 base pair. The 100 base pair. Okay? This is 100. The endonucleus cut site. Okay, the cut site will here. The in the 300, okay? The 300 base pair. This is the 300 base pair. It will be 300. Oh, I'll have to erase this. 300. And the primer 2, okay? 2. The primer 2 is here at the back. So this is 1000, okay? This is 1000. This is 1. This is 1. Primer 1A is 1. I'm sorry. This is 1. Primer 1B is 100, okay? 1B is 100. Here. The cut side is 300. Cut side is 300. And the primer 2 is 1000. Okay. That's the answer. Set, set. Okay. 1B 100. Endo nucleus cut side 300. 2 1000. Okay. These are the answer. Okay. Now I'll explain in Indonesia. Nah, jadi di sini sebelum kita ke situ kita harus bahas ini. Jadi kalian bisa lihat di sini ya. Ini ada anak yang sakit. Kalau dia sakit, berarti cut side-nya itu menghilang, ya. Cut side-nya ini hilang kalau dia sakit. Muscular dystrophy, jadi ini hilang. Kalau dia pakai yang primer 1A, bakal jadi 1000 panjangnya. Berarti ke sini ya. Itu 1000 base pair. Sementara kalau dia pakai yang 1B, itu jadi 900 base pair. Ya, 1B. Berarti 900 base pair. Berarti kan ini ke sini 100 base pair. Ya, berarti primer 1B itu nempelnya di sini, itu di bagian 100 base pair. Ya, ini ada base pair pertama, ini adalah base pair ke 1000. Jadi yang 1A nempel di base pair pertama ya, 1A nempel di base pair pertama, 1B nempel di base pair ke 100 ya. 1B nempel di base pair ke 100. Sementara yang 2 nempel di base pair yang ke 1000. Ya, gitu cara lihatnya. Lalu di sini kita bisa lihat lagi, ayahnya tuh sehat. Sehat. Berarti kan kalau dia pakai 1A ada 2 nih, kan dibagi ada cut side-nya. Kalau dia sehat 700 dan 300, berarti ada 2 di sini dan di sini. Mana yang 700, mana yang 300 kita belum tahu. Nah, lalu kita lihat yang B. 1B ya, dia pakai 1B, berarti mulainya dari sini. 1B itu dia hasilnya 700 ya, ini juga 700 dan 200. Berarti di sini kita bisa tebak ini 200 ya. Karena lebih pendek kan? Berarti yang dari 1 ini, dari 1A ini 300. Ya, bisa kita tebak dari sini ya. Sementara ini kan sama-sama 700. Nah, kalian bisa lihat di sini ini sama-sama 700 ya. Berarti begini. Berarti cut side-nya ini, cut side-nya ini berada di base pair ke 300 ya. Dari awal ini kan base pair pertama, base pair ke 1000. Jadi ini base pair ke yang 300. Jadi cut-nya itu di bagian 300 base pair. Gitu ya cara lihatnya. Nah, sekarang kita ke pertanyaan. Jadi yang 1B itu di 100 ya. Yang 2 itu di 1000 nih ya, yang 2 ini di 1000. Dan cut side-nya itu di 300 ya. Jadi ini jawabannya. Oke? Okay? Begitu. Now to the statement. Dystrophin is on the X chromosome. This is true. Why we have to see this? This father only have this. Okay? Only have this. Why? Because father is XY. Only have one X. This is healthy X. Okay? Because they are separated. Separated meaning healthy. I'm sorry. Healthy. Because if they healthy, they are healthy, they will have cut side. Okay? Healthy. Have cut side. Okay? That's the answer. And the mother is carrier. Okay? Carrier. You can see here. She has the 1000. And she has the separated ones. Okay? The separated ones. So, the mother is carrier. Okay? She has the separated and the non-separated gene. Because she is XX. Okay, X for this and ask for this. Okay, this is healthy. Healthy. This is dystrophin. Dystrophin. Okay, so the mother is carrier, and our child is so sad actually, because he got X from his mother. Okay, from his mother. So Y from his father, and X from his mother. The X from his mother is the dystrophy X. So this is dystrophy. Okay, you can see here, it binds to X chromosome. So this is true. Nah, jadi ya, katanya dystrophin ini menempel pada kromosom X. Itu benar, karena kalian bisa lihat di sini ya. Ini anaknya sakit. Kalau anaknya sakit, berarti kan dia nggak punya sisi pemotongan. Jadi cuma satu gini. Dia nggak terpotong jadi dua. Berarti ini sakit. Sakit. Sementara ini terpotong jadi dua ayahnya. Makanya ayahnya sehat. Ya, ayahnya sehat di sini. Sementara ibunya. Ibunya ada dua nih. Ada yang 1000 ya, kayak anaknya. Ada yang terpisah kayak suaminya. Nah, berarti ibunya karier. Ya, ini adalah X kromosom ibunya. X yang buat sakit ya. XD deh. X dystrophin. Sementara ini yang X normal. Karena kan wanita itu XX ya. Sementara pria itu hanya XY. Jadi X-nya ini X sehat. Ya, ayahnya ini X sehat. Sementara anaknya ini X sakit. Ya, X sakit. Sialnya anaknya ini dapat X dari ibunya. Dari ibunya dapatnya yang sakit. Ya, bukan yang sehat. Y-nya tentu dari ayah. Ya. Nah, jadi ini genotip anaknya. Jadi sudah jelas ya di sini itu dia mengikat pada gen X gitu ya. Jadi itu benar. Now, the second statement is muscular dystrophy is dominant. That's false. Because the mother is carrier. Carrier. Okay. I'm sorry, I have to fix this. Carrier. Okay. Mother is carrier. Carrier means recessive, not dominant. Okay? If there is a carrier, it means the illness is recessive. Okay? Nah, jadi katanya muscular dystrophy itu dominan. Ya, salah lah. Karena ibunya tadi kan carrier. Kalau dia carrier berarti recessive. Ya, kalau nggak ada carrier, baru dominan. Okay, the third statement is dystrophin protein could be made in bacteria with 20 kilobase plasmid. Okay, so we can see here the mRNA only 14 kb. If we use reverse transcriptase, okay, reverse transcriptase, it will become cDNA. Okay, this is mRNA. So if we change that to cDNA, we can use the 20 kb plasmid. This is true because the cDNA only 14 kb. Okay, this is 20 kb. So we can use this. Okay. Nah, jadi katanya kita bisa pakai plasmid berukuran 20 kb. Untuk membuat bakteria yang memiliki dystrophin. Itu benar. Karena kan tadi mRNA-nya itu hanya 14 kb. Bisa kita reverse transcriptase menjadi cDNA. cDNA-nya sepanjang apa? 14 kb juga. Apakah 14 kb ini bisa kita masukkan ke plasmid berukuran 20 kb? Bisa dong. Karena kan besaran plasmidnya. Ya, jadi bisa. Gitu ya. True. Benar. The last statement is many muscular dystrophy patients have new causal mutation. This is true. Why? Because dystrophin gene is a very large gene. It means mutation oftenly occur. Okay? So, for dystrophin, people, many people got dystrophy because of mutation. Okay? Mutations. Not inherit from their parents. Okay? Not inherit from parents. This is de novo mutation. Mutation that's not inherit from parents. Okay? So, just occur naturally because the dystrophin is very, very large. That makes the mutation occur very often. Okay? That's the reason. Or you can see the link in description about the de novo mutation. Okay? You can see the video. I have the link in my description. Nah, jadi katanya kebanyakan distrofi itu karena mutasi de novo. Itu benar. Ya, karena kan tadi kita bisa lihat di sini dia adalah gen yang sangat besar. Jadi kemungkinan mutasinya itu besar sekali, ya. Jadi kebanyakan orang itu dapat distrofi itu bukan dari keturunan tapi dari mutasi. Kebetulan mutasi, ya. Itulah maksudnya de novo. De novo itu adalah mutasi tanpa keturunan dari orang tua, jadi bukan dari orang tua. Itu mutasinya ya kebetulan aja kita kena mutasi, gitu ya. Jadi bukan salah orang tua. Kebanyakan begitu yang distrofi, karena gennya itu besar dan mudah mutasi. So, the answers are true, false, true, true. Jadi jawabannya adalah benar, salah, benar, benar. Now, the 11th question. This is the hardest question here. Okay, so I'll need to prepare. Oh, I have an idea. This will be separated to other video. Okay, this is really hard question. So I'll make a special video for this. Okay, I'll make a special video for this. Maybe next week, maybe 2 weeks after this. I will put the link in comment section. Link in comment. Oh, I'm sorry. Link in the comment section. Cause this is pretty hard, pretty hard. So if I already make the video in the future, I'll give you link in the comment section and I will pin that. Okay? Pin comment. So just wait for this. I'm so sorry I cannot explain this to you today because this is just time consuming, okay? Nah, jadi untuk nomor 11 ini ya, ini lumayan susah jujur aja. Ini lumayan susah jelasinnya karena lumayan panjang jalannya. Jadi, Sensei bakal buat video terpisah untuk ini. Oke, video terpisah. Jadi nanti kalau udah Sensei buat ya, mungkin minggu depan atau 2 minggu lagi itu bakal update dan itu akan ada linknya di pin comment. Ya, jadi nanti ya bakal Sensei pin comment Sensei linknya di bawah nanti ya kalau Sensei udah buat videonya, oke? So, we will skip this for now, oke? To the last question. About the protein evolution. So, this is the last question. You can pause the video and read this intro. Oke. Okay, so this is homolog. Okay, this is homologous. So they are technically similar and have the similar function. Just slightly different. Okay, the function is still the same. Now we can see here the data about the length and the number of cell, and there is not much. Okay, I will read the statement, okay? Nah, jadi di sini kalian bisa baca ini kalau kalian mau pause videonya. Yang jelas di sini ini data-data homolog ya. Jadi ini homolog semua ini. Fungsinya bakal tetap sama. Yang beda itu hanya sedikit ya. Misalnya ini L ini I. Jadi cuma beda satu atau beberapa nukleotida gitu. Eh, bukan nukleotida, ini asam amino ya. Jadi beberapa asam amino aja yang beda. Tapi fungsinya tetap sama ya. Ini ada data panjang juga dan jumlah sel gitu ya. So, to the first statement, CVIM is likely to be zinc dependent. This is false. Why? Because this mark known to be zinc binding. So here we have the zinc binding, but here we have no zinc binding. What's the meaning? It means that zinc independent. They don't really need a zinc, okay? They don't really need a zinc because they are homologous, okay? They are homologous, so have same function. They are only different in structure, like this is L, this is I, this is M, this is V, only that. The function is still the same, okay? That's the meaning of homologous, okay? That's independent, because without zinc, it can perform the same function, okay? That's false. Nah, jadi katanya di sini ya, dia itu zinc dependent, tergantung sama zinc, itu enggak ya. Karena sini kalian bisa lihat, yang ini enggak perlu zinc, ya ini kan enggak ada zinc bindingnya nih, ini enggak ada. Dia masih, fungsinya masih sama kan, karena ini kan mereka homolog, jadi fungsinya sama. Baik yang punya zinc binding maupun yang enggak punya, tetap fungsinya sama. Jadi mereka itu zinc independent, ya mereka enggak perlu kali sebenarnya. Ya, mereka nggak perlu zinc untuk menyalakan fungsinya, gitu ya. Now, the second statement. CVM increase cell survival rate. That's true, because you can see here. If we knock out the CVM, the number of cell will fall down. Okay? That's why CVM increase cell survival rate. Because without CVIM, the survival rate will drop. Okay? Now, to the... Oh yes, di Indonesia ya. Jadi katanya, CVIM itu meningkatkan kemampuan hidup sel. Itu benar ya. Karena kalian lihat di sini, tanpa CVIM, banyak sel yang mati. Ya, jumlahnya menurun. Tapi dengan CVIM, dia bakal tetap hidup. Jadi CVM itu memang meningkatkan keberlangsungan hidupnya mereka, gitu ya. Set. Now the third. Oh, I'm sorry. Set. Now the third statement. CVM very likely plays a role in cell elongation. This is of course true. You can see I'm sorry. This is of course true. You can see without CVIM, the cell length is decreased. Without, knockout means without. Without CVIM, the length will decrease. So, yes, it has a role in cell elongation. Okay, that's true. Nah, jadi katanya CVIM ini punya peran di pemanjangan sel. Itu benar ya, karena kalian lihat di sini, kalau nggak ada CVIM, selnya bakal pendek, gitu ya. Jadi, CVM itu yang ada perannya. Ada perannya di pemanjangan sel. Now, the last statement is, cell elongation is required for survival. That's false. Why? Because cell elongation, here we can see the survival is still the same. Okay, still the same. But the cell is different from the start. Okay, you can see this cell is very long. And the one is short, but they are completely fine. Okay, they are completely fine until this. Okay, until here, they will die. The smaller one will be die. Why? Maybe other factors. I don't really know what's the factors, but not the cell length. Okay, not the cell length. Not the cell length. Cause death. Okay, not the cell length that cause death. Okay, this is what I mean. I hope you can understand me. I'm sorry for my really bad English. Jadi di last statement ini ya, katanya elongasi sel itu diperlukan untuk survival. Sebenarnya nggak juga ya, karena di sini kan ada survivalnya masih sama nih. Sementara ini dari awal udah beda. Ini dari awal panjang, dari awal pendek. Jadi ada yang panjang, ada yang pendek. Tapi sama-sama masih hidup kok. Jadi sebenarnya nggak pala penting sebenarnya kepanjang sel ini ya. Tapi mulai di sini dia mulai mati. yang kecil ini. Kenapa? Sensei juga nggak tahu. Mungkin ada faktor lain. Ya, faktor lain. Yang jelas bukan faktor panjang. Ya, karena faktor panjang ini sebenarnya netral-netral aja. Gitu. Nggak, dia nggak buat mati. Gitu ya. So, the answers are false, true, true, false. Jadi jawabannya adalah salah, benar-benar salah. Oke? Sip! Mantap! Selamat! Ilmu kalian sudah semakin meningkat. Hehe. Jangan lupa like, komen, dan share video ini. Subscribe dan nyalain notifikasinya biar nggak ketinggalan part 2 dari video ini. Alright, congratulations. Your knowledge increases. Hehe. Don't forget to like, comment, and share this video. Subscribe and turn on the notification bell so that you can be notified when the part 2 of this video is released. Thanks for your attention. See you later, Otsusenku. Doing, 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 doing.